Working till I'm 65, 70 years old just isn't going to cut it. I'm 19 and I plan on retiring in the next 7 to 10 years. What's your plan? There's some simple steps you need to follow in order to retire 40 to 50 years earlier than expected. Come to one of our mentorship seminars and let us teach you how to do that. No, we're not selling you on anything once you get there. Instead, we're actually going to give you free materials and information that will let you better understand our concepts. As a matter of fact, leave your checkbook and credit cards at home. Log in as a guest, register for the next seminar in your area, and get started today.
Most of you know Jonathan. Jonathan is my youngest, who refuses to go to college.
Excellent.
And, you know, when you consider what does it cost to go to college, you have to think about it. It's not the same thing as it was 20 years ago. But the real reason why is, number one is, he's a sharp young man, and he said, "Dad, but whatever it is you're doing, it's what I'm doing." He says, "Because whatever it is that you did worked for you." And he pretty much wanted to be everything I've done as he grew up, as he got older. I'm a car enthusiast, and I have a couple of antiques, and I work on them, so. As he grew up, he said to me, "I'm going to be just like your dad, I'm going to work on cars." And then when he got a little bit smart and he realized that, wow, that's not what I want to do, because that's not what he does. So he said, "Well, Dad, I want to go to law school and become a lawyer, because I did law for 22 and a half years." And then as he got a little older and started helping me with the seminars, he said, "Dad, I want to do real estate. That's what I want to do." And so I said to him, "Well," I said, "I really do need you to go at least 2 years, at least accounting or some type of business background so that you can grow in the company." I said, because you're my son doesn't mean you're qualified to run it. And so he said to me, "Well, Dad, that's a good topic." He said, "Who is going to run your company when you die?" He was at 17 when we had this conversation. And I said, "Well, it ain't gonna be you because you're not even an adult yet. You're still, back then he was 17. He's 19 now. I have three boys. One of them is almost done with law school. He'd have been here, but he's in a marriage retreat." And I said, "No, go. The better, the more the better, right?" And my two oldest are there, and Jonathan's at the hotel. But he said, "Well, which one are your boys?" I said, "Well, the three of you combined will be able to do what I do." And I joke around with them like that, but think about it. You have to learn what it is you're going after. You have to be focused to learn it. Because reality is, some of you have spent a lot of time with me, and you need to learn, because we live in a time and age that tomorrow isn't promised to us. So I want you all to learn. The purpose of learning is so that you can do it and teach it and pass it forward, okay?
You know, the despair of, wait, you know, this is, you know, this is the moment. This is everything that built up, you know, in my mind. This is not it. You want to win. And you want to succeed, and you want to represent success, and you dream about more success. And
people stick a finger in your face and tell you you're no good. And when things got hard, you started looking for something to blame.
Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done.
That's why you put everything in it.
Don't ever let somebody tell you you can't do something.
Investments that are incredible, you know, someone else may look at and say, man, you know, if you do this and you're successful, then it's wow, you know, that
guy. You want something, go get it, period.
But until you start believing in yourself, you ain't gonna have a life.
We're going to outstrain and out-hit these guys. Let them know. Leave no doubt tonight. Leave no doubt tonight. You help, you strain, and you just fight. Start fast. It's a game, lad. Let's have fun and go get us a big victory.
Winning is not a sometime thing. It's an all-the-time thing. You don't win once in a while. You don't do things right once in a while. You do them right all the time. Winning is a habit.
You know, some people tell me, why am I so positive? I can go back to, I was born in the Bronx, and I share with people a lot of times about my past. And most of you know me, like a few new folks, but nothing can stop me except me. Nothing can stop you except you. The problem is that we're too easily influenced by others and others' situations and others' circumstances. We're the ones that determine where I go. I determine how far I get. You know, somebody will say something to me, and I'll look for a positive way to get around it, no matter what it is. It does not matter whatever the circumstances, there is something positive. I learned from my pastor one day, and he is probably the most positive man I know on earth, Mark. Some of you know him. And one day, he was thanking the Lord for the fence, telling me what a great fence that was. I just thought when I first met him that he was out there. And I realized that if you're thankful for everything, you'll enjoy everything. And yeah, how many of you know that sometimes we have bad days? But they don't have to be. You just get over it and move on. The other day, I'll give you an example. I just recently got a new car. And I hadn't had it 4 days, and I ripped the front bumper off. $100,000 car.
Kind of car?
Used.
Right, $100,000 used car. What happened was I came into a parking lot at the hotel, and there was a rebar sticking out of the parking stop. But it was leaned in that direction, so when I pulled in, the bumper just grabbed it and went over it. And then it set in there. And then I backed up, and I thought, I said, there's something. So I put the window down. I said, there's something underneath the car. And so I didn't hear anything. So I backed up again, and it went, and ripped the front bumper off. So I got out, I looked at it, and I smiled. Because that does not make me. It inconvenienced me. How many of you know that everything that happens will inconvenience you? Yeah. But everything in life requires action or reaction. I like the action. My first thought was, you know what, I'm gonna have to get one of the guys to take me home because the thing was stuck, it wouldn't let go. My second thought was, action, not reaction. So I took off my jacket, got on my knees. I used to work on cars a long time ago. get under it, and I untied it. Rebar was stuck to what's called a radiator support. It's amazing that the airbag didn't deploy. But it didn't stop me. I pinned it up, hooked it up, and I went home. And the next day, I just didn't deal with it. Just let me share another story. I have a Hummer, and one day, my son Jonathan, when he was 14, and my nephew Victor, when he was 16, said, "Dad, Uncle, we need $50 to go to Busch Gardens." And, oh, wow, $50. We're back, because I don't think it costs $50 anymore. I think we paid, what, $90 to get in there?
Each.
for one day. And I said, "Well, if you guys wash and wax my car, I'll give you guys $50 each." I said, "But I want it inside, outside, everything." I said, "But you got to start it early, because once that sun gets out there, it's going to be tough." I said, "And what you want to do is put on wax a little bit, wax on, and wax off just a couple of minutes later." Well, my son Jonathan, who is brilliant in his own little mind, said, "Why do we have to do the wax in little bits? Why don't we just put the wax on the whole car?
Oh.
And then we'll take the wax off." Well, that sounded like a good idea to both of them. And then by the time they put the whole wax on the whole car, they say, "You know, it's about lunchtime. Why don't we take a lunch break, go inside, and then take the wax off?"
Yeah.
And it baked on the car. 90 plus degrees in the state of Florida. And so they went in and they couldn't take the wax off. So my son had another brilliant idea, and he said, "Why don't we go in the kitchen? Mom has those little yellow and green scouring pads."
Oh, no.
"And the rough side, the green side, we'll just scrape the wax from the bank." Well, they didn't think that, but that's what they were going to do. So I said, "Man, boys haven't called me. The office wasn't very far from the house." So I said, "Let me just go by and see how they're doing with my car." And I pull in the Via Segovia, and it's a corner lot. There, one of them was on his knees on top of my hood going on the front of the car. I had it for about a week and a half. And I said, "What are you guys doing? The wax won't come off." I said, "I see that, but what are you doing?" He said, "We're scraping it off." They had scraped the whole nose of the vehicle. All the shiny part was gone. I looked at it, and my first reaction was, "I'm gonna kill these kids. I'm going to prison today for killing my son and my nephew." My second action was, "Guys, and just get off the car." And mind you, one of them is hanging on the back of the bumper doing the top, and the other one's on the hood, on knees and doing this. "Come on down, guys. I think you guys did enough waxing to the car. So why don't we do this? I'm going to give you guys the money so you guys can go to Busch Gardens right now. Okay, you don't have to leave at 2. You can leave right now." I just saved their lives. And my wife says, "Oh, my goodness." I said, "You know what? Leave it alone. It's not worth it. Getting them set up." I left the car there for a week until I found somebody that would come pick it up, and I didn't even want to get in the car. It was a big hit. It was a big, because the kid lived with me, so every time I saw him, I thought about the car. And he said, "Dad, but do you want us to finish?" No, don't finish the car. You guys did enough on the car. What I'm saying is, some stuff is worse. A car, you could replace that any day of the week. Your health, your life, your happy. Are you really, really happy? Or are you, like the video said, just content? Life will give you some shots that you can't get up from, but you've got to try. We look at videos every week, and we were looking at inspirational videos, And this morning, I couldn't but be emotional because Nick, I don't know what his name is, the guy with no arms, and have you seen him?
Yeah.
Fabulous. If you have not seen his video, no arms, no legs, nothing. The only thing that'll stop you is you. You know, and why am I saying this? And I'll get into the presentation in a little bit. We got William's going to talk to us a little bit about credit. And I tell you, he's incredible. If you have, even if you don't have, I'm using him. Because, you know, you want to have perfect credit. You know, I don't think I've ever seen anybody at the 900 mark. I think that it's the highest, but nobody gets there. 850, 860. He is incredible. We do a lot with owner financing and credit for conventional. Those are some of the tools you have to get involved with. So in a minute, he'll come up and talk to us about that. But nothing can stop us. Nothing. And some of you have been through, you know, if I go to some of your homes, some of you have libraries of investment courses and books. I know.
How you know?
You can keep it in my window.
This is the norm. See, we actually tricked you. What we actually got you here to sell you the program. The lock, right? The lock. Okay. This is from 1992. Somebody bought a wealth builders program. And somebody had a dream in 1992 with this one. Never been opened. Never been opened.
Yes.
What are the chances that this person was successful?
Zero.
Some of you continue buying stuff. When we tell you that you will not have to buy anything, that you will not have to use your credit card for any software or for any programs, we mean it. That you will not have to, some of us, have spent tens and $20,000 and $50,000 in mentorship, only to find that to get to the level that you wanted, you had to spend another 10, 20 more. And that's okay. You know what, Mike? We're glad we did that, because now we're together with you and we're moving forward. Some of you have been thinking about doing real estate and investing for many years, and that's all you're doing, thinking about. And some of you are involved. Hey, if you're involved with a project with us, please raise your hand. 10, 12, 13 people. What we want to do is real simple. If I said, Pretty, please stand up for a second.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask Pretty to pick up this screen and take it to the front lobby by herself. You think she can do it? I don't want her to drag it. I want her to pick it up.
In the middle.
Now,
she'll
try. Yeah. Some of us will get her trying to do it. And I got some stronger guys out back, you know, like Harold and Valio. They'll probably be able to do it, right? But if I said, all right, you two, the five of us, the six of us, let's get it. It'd be a lot easier, right? Because teamwork makes the dream work. And that's what we're talking about. I'm going to bring William for a minute. And he's going to share with us.
I want to feel important, like most of these big time speakers where you go pay thousands and thousands of dollars, you know, for those seminars and workshops. I don't have any of that. But I like that. I like that applause that they get. And of course, like Mike said, there you go. Of course, Mike said, you know, you buy this course right, then you don't open it. It ends up sealed in the package. So, you know what? My service, which, how many people here know me? You got to be short. Okay, so we have some new people here. Let me see a hand of the new people.
Okay, we do have some new people.
Okay, great. Pretty quick. My name is William Crowley, and I do credit restoration. I'll take my cards and pass them off, but those, I'm short on cards, so if you already have one, don't take it, okay? Just take it for, just passing it on for those of you who don't have one. On the card, I have a new website, okay?
So we can take it then.
No, not on that card. You're going to have to write it on that one. I've got the new ones being made. So you can write it on the back of that one.
We saw you like it two weeks ago.
Yeah, so you got it. You should have written it on there because I gave it out.
You did?
I gave that website out, yeah. If not, then just take another one.
I'll take one.
Yeah, I don't have the fancy cars like Mike. I've got a 92 Volvo and I got a minivan. So I've got to be tight with my cars. Nevertheless, I do credit restoration assistance, okay? And it's a good program, but I get a lot of people that do the same thing that they did when they bought this kid. Now, this kid is much more expensive than my credit restoration program. But they sign up, they pay, then they don't do anything with it. And then ironically, some of them come and tell me they want their money back. Now, it doesn't work that way, folks, okay? If you do what I tell you in my program, it'll work.
Appreciate it.
It'll work. And if it doesn't, I'll be more than happy to give you money back. But on my card, it says money back guarantee. So those of you who have my card now, on the back of it, you might want to write this new website down. It's lengthy, and Shane's going to show me a way to abbreviate it. But right now, I'm going to make it burdensome on you. You ready? www, of course you know that. Bad. It's real, real short. Bad. Credit. History repaired.com.
We're working on it.
Bad credit history repaired past tense.com. Okay, everybody got that? Real short. And Shane and Mike are trying to get me to abbreviate it. They're going to show me how. So next time I'll be able to probably give you the acronym. But for now, you're going to write it all the way out. Now, I have a four-stage credit restoration assistance program. Some of you know it as credit repair, okay? I hate that word because most of the credit repair people out there pretty much running a scam, and most of them aren't knowledgeable about credit repair, okay? That kind of sounds boastful, right, for me to say that, a little guy like me. Okay, I've been doing it since 1999, and I've been through a lot of the companies, worked for some of them, and then kind of competed with the rest of them. Disputing information on your credit report is not credit repair, okay? And I know some of you have went to the internet and became experts because you disputed a couple items on your credit report and miraculously some of the information came off. You have no idea what you did, okay? My program is not like that. You're gonna know just as much as I know about the service. Like I said, it's credit restoration assistance. That's the key word, assistance. I'm going to assist you in cleaning up your credit using a four-stage process. Now, here are the four stages, okay? First step is disputing the information on your credit report. And I know some of you that have tried to do it, some of you experts, you've taken the four disputes that they have online. It was not mine, I was never late, the other two crazy ones as well, okay? Well, I want you to, we look at the Fair Credit Reporting Act, and I would encourage you to do the same thing. Look at the Fair Credit Reporting Act. Everybody's heard of the Fair Credit Reporting Act. How many people have read it?
It's too long to read.
Ah, there you go. I heard this gentleman just say it out loud.
It's too long to read.
It's too long to read. It can be costly, though. Ignorance is expensive, okay? So that's why I want to lessen that for you because I have read it. And I use the Fair Credit Reporting Act to dispute the negative information on your credit reports. Now, it's about 96 pages of laws, and it's written in legalese. So most of us, we talk in layman's terms, so we have no idea what they're talking about. Even me. I even knowing legalese, I still sometimes don't have any idea what they're talking about. What separates me from most of the people out there is trial and error. Okay, I have no idea which disputes work for which item on a credit report. If you're looking at my card, I've got a list of negative items on there. Bankruptcies, foreclosures, late payments, tax liens, charge-off, collections, etc. On and on and on. Inquiries as well. Okay, that does in fact belong to you, right? Most people come to me, the information does in fact belong to them. So a lot of people don't even come to me and say, well, this information is mine. So you can't get it off. But once you read the Fair Credit Reporting Act and decipher the hieroglyphics in there, you may say, wait a minute, this information can come off. Why? Because they're violating due process. That's why. It's not that you didn't do it. We know that you did. Okay? But I want to help you and be on your team. Most of you are investors in here. I want to be on your team, help you possibly and or your clients to overcome some of those obstacles, because there is some financing involved. And when you're talking about financing, you're talking about lending institutions that have certain requirements. And your credit score is the first thing they look at. They don't look at your pocketbook, they look at your credit score. So I'm here to help you in overcoming those objections. Now, are you a bad person because you have bad credit? Most of the time, no. Because nobody goes out to accumulate credit to not pay it back. Your intention is to pay it back. But you run into obstacles throughout your life, and especially with this economy up and down, you're going to run into obstacles. So you're not able to fulfill your financial obligations. Therefore, you default, and it reflects on your credit report in the form of a negative mark. So what I'm here to do is not to judge you. I want to say, I don't care what your circumstances are. If you have negative information on your credit report, I can help you overcome that. Okay? Look at my program, and then it's going to show you everything to do step by step. So back to the Fair Credit Reporting Act, FCRA, we're going to take that, and we're going to use that against the negative information on your credit report, regardless of what the information is, the nature of it, okay? Some people tell me, like I was talking to a guy in Ohio, he saw some of my information on TV or some of the shows I've done. He called me last night, and he said, well, I've got a bankruptcy. I mean, that's going to be hard, right? I mean, that's not like an inquiry. Me, I don't care whether it's an inquiry or bankruptcy or tax lien or judgment or whatever. No matter what you consider minor or major, that's not in my verbiage, okay? I don't care, because what I'm going after the credit reporting agencies for is due process. They have violated the laws of the Fair Credit Reporting Act. Some of you all know O.J. Simpson, right? Some of you, O.J.? Well, he may not have done it. I'm not here to judge him. All I'm saying is that his attorneys did their job, okay? His attorneys did their job. And that's what I am. I'm not your attorney, but I'm your credit repair representative, and I'm going to do my job. I'm not here to say whether you did it or you didn't do it. All I know is that the negative information is there, and I'm going to address it. I should be able to remove 100%. And I know that a lot of these guru speakers that you pay $1,000 go here to give you all these guarantees. I don't guarantee you anything but your money back if I can't produce results. Okay? That's what I guarantee. Because I know that I'm dealing with one of the most corrupt institutions in the United States, which is the credit reporting agency, which are private companies and not affiliated with the government. The information that they put on your credit report, they must get your permission before they do that. Anybody here been called by the credit reporting agency? Anybody?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So, Sam says yes. You've been called by the credit reporting agency?
I've been called, yes.
It's probably a collector, not a credit reporting agency.
Oh, collector, because,
The credit reporting agency, they don't call you.
Okay.
But they should.
Thank you.
I'm going to get to the collection that company in just a minute, okay? But the credit reporting agency, you should receive a call every time there's a transaction on your credit report. You should be updated by the credit reporting agency. Why? Because they've got to verify. They've got to make sure that this information is true and correct that they're about to put on your credit report, because they received it from a third party, the lenders. They don't know if it's true or not. All they know is that they've got some information. You're late on a payment. You just bought a mortgage. You just bought a home. You just bought a car. You just had a car repossessed. Whether it's negative or positive, they have to verify it. They're not doing that. They're not. So what do? I go after the credit reporting agencies for violation of due process. That's what I'm doing, folks. And that's what most credit repair, so-called credit repair companies, should be doing. But the difference between me and them, once again, is I'm going to show you every dispute we use, and we're going to send it to you to send out to the credit reporting agency. I'm not behind the scenes writing up some Mickey Mouse disputes that you never will see, and I'm sending it off to the credit reporting agency. No. You're going to be sending it off to the credit reporting agency after we construct it. So the only thing you have to do is mail and receive. That's all you have to do. You're the middleman. Credit reporting agency will not communicate with me. So that's the Fair Credit Reporting Act that we're going to use to go after the negative information on the credit report. Then in the middle of my card, you see this word, I like to use this word, it's VODs, not a venereal disease. This is validation of debts, okay? Validation of debts, that's what the acronym VOD stands for. Now, what is that? Sam just said he received a call. Now, you have received a call from a collector if at any time you defaulted on a debt. You have or you will receive a call. They will call you. They're not calling you to verify anything, but because the assumption is that you do owe the debt. So in a deceiving manner, they're going to call you and try to entice you into paying a debt that you don't owe. Okay? Now, see, the credit reporting agency should be operating from that perspective in a legal way. But they're not. Now, the collectors are operating from that perspective, not to determine whether the debt is yours or not. They're determining whether you're going to pay and how soon you're going to pay. Now, how does that work? Most people that come to me in the past have had collection and charge-off accounts. Now, we got into that because of the fact that when we're disputing information on the credit report, it alerts the collectors, hey, we better start to contact this client because we don't want to, if it's deleted off the credit report, they may forget about paying this debt. Or they may not feel the necessity to pay this debt because it's been deleted from the credit report. Okay? So they're going to immediately start calling you. We want them to call you, and we want you to answer the phone. I know something that most of us aren't used to doing when you owe debts that you didn't pay. But we want you to pay these debts, okay? We want you to have dialogue with these collectors. Call them. Talk to them. Either they're going to call you or you can call them. We encourage you to do that. Why? Because we're going to address the issue from a legal perspective now. No more than running and hiding and all that. And some of you who profess to be religious, you should be paying your debts. And you shouldn't be letting all this stuff happen, right? And I like to pick on people, religious people, because a lot of them are hypocrites. Because they don't do what they're supposed to do. And I love to say that to you, okay? Stop acting like a hypocrite and do what you're supposed to do. Okay, and I'm going to help you in doing that by addressing the negative information on your credit reports in a legal fashion. So we delete the information, then we go after the collectors with the validation debt. What happened? How did it happen? When you go out and accumulate debt, if you don't pay on the debt, it's going to automatically charge off. That brings me to another question. Okay, there's no reason in the world for people to file bankruptcies. Some, but very little reason for people to file bankruptcy because the debts are going to charge off anyway. That's a form of bankruptcy. When a debt charges off, it's a form of bankruptcy. Because why? Because the original creditor has received payment in some form or fashion for the debt because they were unable to collect it from you. Now, it releases you of any financial obligation, therefore, because the debt's been charged off by the original creditor. They have insurance on these accounts. I'm not encouraging you not to pay your debts, but when misfortune happens, then there's an automatic default mechanism put in place by the Uniform Commercial Code that allows you to say, okay, this debt is going to be taken care of in a different fashion.
I got a question for you.
Okay, Sam.
What the call was about years ago.
Oh, Sam, to clarify that.
Well, you asked if anybody ever had.
Yeah, we'll call from the credit report agency.
Yeah, before I got that confused. Anyway, what had happened was that my wife's son, my stepson.
Are you recording me? You keep recording me.
Went in the hospital from a high school accident years ago. And being adolescent, of course, my wife had to sign, but he was on the insurance of the athletic program, okay? For some reason, they didn't pay.
Yeah, that's insurance that we most of the time do.
Yeah, they didn't pay.
For some reason, they don't pay.
Now, we're thinking all is taken care of. Then, 7 years later, we get this call, and they're saying, you owe X number of dollars, and it was in my wife's name. So we went back and checked the records and everything, and she was never admitted into the hospital during this, let's say, 2003. All right? So we disputed it. And they said, well, you still owe, because the records show that there was a service rendered to my wife, and which was not accurate. We discovered that it was the son, but they still said we owe. Now, the hospital, we checked, charged it off. You know, but the credit agencies, they buy the debt.
The collectors.
The collectors, thank you again. Collectors buy the debt and they try to get you to pay.
Exactly.
So what's the outlet on that?
Okay, here we go. Yeah, now I can finish this out. Wait.
Yeah.
So the original creditor charges the debt off. You're no longer financially obligated. You understand that, right? Because the original creditors charge it off. They do that because if they don't, then they become responsible for the debt. Okay, they do, in a way, become responsible for their debt. So they have it coming up on them to charge the debt off, which releases them of any financial obligation to the debt. It also releases you of any financial obligation to the debt. That's the original creditor. They're the only ones that have the power to do that. So when it's charged off, why would you turn around and pay a third party, which is called a collector, that debt? Most people do that because they're not aware of the rights that protect them. They haven't read the Fair Credit Reporting Act. They haven't read the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, nor have they read the Constitution or the Uniform Commercial Code. All of the laws of commerce that help us as consumers. So since most of you aren't going to do that, I've done that, and I want to assist you in helping you to straighten out your credit this way. So I'm going to go after the collector, and I'm going to encourage you to have dialogue, not to throw their letters away, any correspondence that they send you, or if they call you, not to shut them off. You want to be friendly with these people because all they're doing is their job. Okay, we all know what the acronym for job is, but anyway. Right, we do know. Okay, so they're just doing their job, okay? So we want to help them to do their job more effectively by helping them understand the laws, because most of the people that call you don't know the laws either. They've just been told by their master, by their boss, to collect on this debt. And they do just like a normal slave would do, they do what they're told, okay? And that's a slave is just a fancy word for those of us who have jobs that work on them for the rest of our lives as well. And we want to stop that madness. So anyway, I'm going to tell you, when the collector calls you, we'll put them on notice, okay? I need you to send this to me in writing. Don't mention validation of debt to them, okay? Just tell them, send it to me in writing and I'll be more than happy to settle this matter. Don't say pay, say settle the matter. Oh, you mean you're going to pay Mr. Crawley? Send me the letter and I'll be more than happy to settle this matter. That's all. I don't do business over the phone. I want it in writing. When you get it in writing, then you're going to immediately forward it to my office. And we're going to construct what you call a VOD, a validation of debt. I'm going to send that to the collector along with their letter. 9 times out of 10, you won't hear from that collector again. Now, why not? Why won't you hear from them again? Because you're putting them on notice that this debt has been charged off by the original creditor. I'm no longer officially responsible or financially responsible for this debt because the original creditor has satisfied it through a charge-off. But if you have some type of revelation that I do owe this debt and you can produce me with the original note, I'll be more than happy to settle the matter. Because they don't have the original note. The original creditor charged off. You would never hear from the original creditor ever again. That should raise a red flag or a false flag to you right there. Why isn't the original creditor calling me then? If I still owe them the debt, why is this third party, ABC Collection, calling me, telling me that they're representing Bank of America, Wells Fargo, Visa, or MasterCard, or whomever? That should raise a red flag to you. But we're going to help you to understand that. So we're going to send the validation of debt to them because the collector just bought the debt at a huge discount. Okay, that's what it is. They buy large amounts of debt, okay, for huge discounts. And then they come after you for full face value plus penalties and fees. That's what they do. That's the gambit that they're running on us. Now just think, you and all your clients that are out there that has had damaged credit and you're out there paying all these collectors off, why not take this money and invest it in Mike's opportunity? He's not selling you a kit that you're going to package up. How do you get over there? That's pretty neat. I thought y'all Houdini was in the house over there. Anyway, okay, so the kit is over there now. That's still packaged. Okay, Mike, you can invest with Mike, taking this money instead of throwing it away and just burning it, and investing in something that you're going to work on right here and now. You're not going to put it on a shelf or something like that. So that's what I mean. I want to work with Mike in that capacity to help him take you all and or your clients, and there's going to be more people coming at each workshop and seminar, and help you to keep that money in your pocket. And now you're legally dealing with your debt because we're going to issue the collector a validation of debt and put them on notice. Don't worry about this debt any longer. I'm dealing with it in an official capacity. And you can please feel free to call me anytime, and I'll be more than happy to deal with this matter. Now, those are the first two steps of my credit restoration, which are the most important. Okay? Now, the final two, because I know I haven't got much time, and I know Mike's got to get back up here because he got a lot of important information to share with you today. Okay, the last two is the Federal Trade Commission follow-up letter. Okay, that's the third step. What that means is if the credit reporting agencies do not respond to you within the given time frame, which is how many days, pretty?
45.
There you go. 45 days. I give them the benefit of doubt. It's 30 business days, which is probably equivalent to about 45 days because we're excluding holidays and weekends. Okay, so we're going to give them 45 days. If they don't respond, what do we do? Somebody. You call them, you say? Well, not them, you want to call me. Yeah. Okay, let me know, because I'm working for you. That's what you're paying me for. Right. You're paying me to do that, okay? So if they don't respond to you in 45 days, and I'm not a mind reader, so I have to, I'm relying on you to call me and let me know, hey, William, they haven't responded to me, it's been 45 days. I'm going to immediately produce a Federal Trade Commission follow-up letter. Why the Federal Trade Commission? Because they oversee and enforce the Fair Credit Reporting Act, the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, and any other consumer laws that are out there to protect us. Okay? Put them to work for us. That's what we're going to do. So we're going to take that letter and construct it for you, send it to you, you're going to forward it to them. Now, keep in mind, I want you to make copies. Shane, why are you laughing? Shane saw this thing about what did it call it, the greatest salesman? Y'all got to go look at that. Well, say it right quick, on YouTube?
Yeah, the world's greatest salesman.
World's greatest salesman. He's selling the cleaner that you can eat yourself and all like that. This guy is hilarious. I haven't looked at it yet, but Shane had me just laughing and telling me about it. And he said, I kind of remind him of that. I want to make sure you're correct. I'm not a salesperson, okay? I want to make sure you're clear on that, okay? I'm not. I want you to take my program, steak knives, I want you to take my program and understand it and know how it works. And then use it on yourself and on your clients, okay? So the Federal Trade Commission, we're gonna make them do what they're supposed to do in enforcing the Fair Credit Reporting Act. So if the credit reporting agency does not respond, then they're going to respond now with the Federal Trade Commission. And what's gonna happen when they intervene is that everything that you disputed now has to come off, legally be deleted, because the credit reporting agency did not respond to your plea with your Fair Credit Reporting Act, 1681I of the Fair Credit Reporting Act. They did not respond in the given time frame. So now the whole idea of the Federal Trade Commission intervening is to have everything deleted that you disputed now. Should work, okay? But it's not 100% guaranteed there either. But the Federal Trade Commission will get involved, maybe not to have everything deleted like they're supposed to by law, but they will force the credit reporting agency to respond. That's what we want, is that correspondence between that communication, that dialogue between you and the credit reporting agency from a different perspective, not you running and hiding any longer. Okay, so that's the Federal Trade Commission followed up. Now last is the cease and desist. Some of you heard about that. I don't like them, but it does serve in a certain capacity. In this capacity here, it's okay. If your collectors are calling you at work or at home, at work or your family or friends, etc., then we want to introduce to them or implement letter, a cease and desist. I don't want them to stop communicating with you. I want the collectors to communicate with you because we're going to deal with them with the validation of debt, and we're going to shut them down in a legal format. Okay? But if they're calling your home, harassing your home or your family or friend, then we'll issue a cease and desist. So we'll do that. That's the four-stage credit restoration program that we do. Not that credit repair, Mickey Mouse credit repair, where I'm just disputing negative information on your credit report, and lo and behold, I'm gone, and maybe you've had two or three items deleted, etc. Okay? We're going to get between 60 to 80% of the negative information removed from your credit report. We'll stop over 90% of those collectors with the Fair Credit Reporting Act, with the validation of debt. Now, in doing my program, I want you to make sure you keep records of everything. You're watching me just like we're watching you. So we encourage you to make copies of all our correspondence before you forward it to the credit reporting agency or before you forward it to us. Why? Because eventually we're going to start suing the credit reporting agencies. Every deletion that you have on that credit report, you can make up to $5,000 per deletion. Okay, per report. So if you have a repossession that's on Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion, and you stand to make $5,000, I'll delete off each three. How much is that?
$15,000
for one negative entry on the credit report that the credit reporting agency has to pay you. Defamation of character, libel, etc. Because that's what they're doing. They're hindering your process, hindering your progress, because you can't go out and accumulate loans at the decent interest rates, and most of the time you're being turned down for these loans. So make sure that you keep records of all of my information, especially those of you who are already in my program. This is just a refresher course. Make sure that you're doing what I tell you. Please do it, okay? Please do it. Now, here's the last thing I want you to do, okay? You ready? Give me a real good hand of applause, and then I'll sit down, okay? Let's go, fire. All right, thank you.
It happened to me. Mm-hmm. So I went to debt, and it wasn't a big amount, it was a couple of thousand. And they told me I lost my job. I ended up in this, I couldn't work, I was in hospital. Mm-hmm. Come to the hospital, I couldn't pay them nothing. Right. They told me when I wrote to them and told them what happened. I never heard from them for a couple of months. Then I get a letter state. No, sorry, it's online. I got a phone call. It was from a creditor. They passed it on,
right,
to creditors.
Mm-hmm.
These creditors said to me, I owe so much, I have to pay them. I said, all right, I admit to owing the debt.
Mm-hmm.
I explained it to them.
Right.
They said, I'm sorry, we still have to collect.
Right.
Otherwise, we're going to come and root something from you, your car. So I said, look, don't threaten me, I'm telling you. I left it as that.
Yeah.
A couple of months later, they phoned again, I need to pay. I said, all right, look, I commit I do owe you. I can only pay you $10 to $20 a month.
$20
here, right? $10 to $20 a month. That's all I can pay you. Because my wife and I, we worked everything out, that's what we can pay you. You don't accept it. You either pay us now in full or we leave. And I got scared.
Mm-hmm.
So I contacted them, they still came on again. Then I said, all right, look, you want to take me to court? Take me to court.
Right.
And I left. I never heard from them again.
Now, you will hear from them again, I guarantee you. Sometimes they shut down for a couple, even a couple years at times, okay? But they never forget their money. So what we want to do is, we got to speak their language. See, we speak in a foreign language to them when you say, oh, well, I'll pay you $10 to $20, because they want the whole sum, okay? That's the purpose of the validation of debt, because you don't owe the debt any longer. It's not the original creditor calling you. 9 times out of 10, now they have two types of collectors, in-house and your original collectors, okay? The internal is the ones that work directly for the creditor where they haven't charged it off yet. So they have all the right in the world to try to collect on their debt because it's not yet charged off. But most of the time, those are what you call the external collectors who bought the debt after it's been charged off by the original creditor. So you need to establish that when they call. And the best way to do that is to review your credit report. It'll indicate that on the credit report in the form of profit and loss write-off, charge off, just plain write off or something to that manner, okay? So review your credit report if you're ever getting calls and you're kind of leery on whether this is a legal debt collector or not. 9 times out of 10, if it's a collector calling you, and if you're unaware, we'll submit a validation debt, and that'll bring them out of the woodwork because they will have to address that in a legal format, and they don't like legal formats, okay? They deal with flying under the radar. They just want to call you up and then you commence in a payment plan to pay the debt. Not no $10 to $20 though, okay? They want to get, you know, 50, 60, depending on the amount of the debt. So we just want to make sure that we close these collectors down. I don't want you to ignore them, but I don't want you to start entering any type of payment arrangements with them either. Just tell them to send it to me in writing and I'll be more than happy to settle this matter. Be sincere with them because they're doing their job. Have enough respect for them for that. But also you want to educate them. Hey, just send it to me. I'm not saying I'm going to pay it just yet. I need to see this. I need to know who you are. I need to know who's calling my house because you're not the original creditor. You're a third party. You could be my next door neighbor. I don't know who you are. So let me first you need to identify yourself, and then we can go from there. Okay? So that's what we're going to. Now, Sam did say, did I answer your question, Sam? Because you gave me the thing about right validation of debt on the collector. Sir?
Yeah, that's a quick question. So if you're not ever legally obligated to pay a third-party creditor, then, and that's their whole business, isn't then so their whole business based on that you don't understand the law?
Right.
Well, let me rephrase that, okay? Because you do legally owe even the collectors once the original creditor charges off until you establish that. You have to establish that, but that by the issuance of a validation of debt. So remember, all of this is your fault, okay? Like Mike was saying earlier, it's all our fault, okay? So we just got to know how to circumvent some of these actions, because right now, when you're the collector, you do all that money until you put the collector on the right format, right, on the right path.
Okay, so you technically still owe it, but you have to first acknowledge that you don't owe them, kind of thing.
Right. So look at it as though you do owe them until you address it in a legal format. And that's the best way to address it in a legal format is the issuance of a validation of debt. So I don't want any of you to think, oh, I don't owe that. You do owe it until you address it properly. Okay?
All
right, ma'am.
After you start making payments to a credit card company because of whatever reason, a car accident, you lost your job, whatever
mm-hmm.
it is,
mm-hmm.
how long does it take for the original creditor
charge
off that debt?
Okay. Usually it takes between 90 to 180 days for the original creditor to charge the debt off. And then maybe 90 to 180 days additional days for the collectors to start contacting. Okay? But when you stop paying, from the day you stop paying, 90 to 180 days is when it's going to charge off. But always review your credit report, and you can review your credit report at least once a year, all three, Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion, by going to one of the free credit sites. I recommend annualcreditreport.com. That's annualcreditreport.com. Review that once a year, and then you can determine what is and is not charged off on your credit report. As a matter of fact, you can determine your whole status. And I would encourage you to all pull your credit report at least once a year or sign up for one of those monitoring services where you can review it on a daily basis so you can know exactly when information is or is not charging off. Okay?
Well, for the individuals that have good credit, what can you offer them?
Keep your credit good. keep it good, but keep me in mind, keep in your back pocket in case you does go bad. Now, let me answer, say more on that. Because people with good credit, sometimes they still have blemishes on their credit. I would tell you to address that information. Don't just let it sit there. Because if some junk just going to come back and plague you. If you have good credit and you're getting an interest rate of 2%, if you have excellent credit, you can get an interest rate of 0%. Okay? So if you have any type of blemishes on your credit report, address these issues. Don't just let them sit there. Okay? Because I have people that I do credit scores of 800, and I have people that I do credit scores of 300. I don't discriminate. I'll take any and all, black, white, yellow, pink, orange, whatever. Okay, any score. All right.
How many points on average did you gain after these flaws are removed?
Great question. I have no idea. That's a great question, okay? What I'm in the business of doing is cleaning up credit. Your credit is determined on your past credit history, past positive credit history, versus your past negative. When I come in the situation, when I come in, my job is to remove as much negative as possible. As I'm removing that negative, your existing positive versus the now new negative that you have is going to determine your credit score. So I have no idea. I don't even care about score. All I care about is addressing the negative information on your credit report. And if you now, I've given people to come to me with no positive, whether in the past or present. Okay, so first thing I want to do, once again, is I'm going to attack all the negative. Let's get as much of that negative information off as possible. Then I can show you ways, and even Mike could show you ways to accumulate positive trade lines to get that score boosted up. Okay? All right. If I have more, yeah, there we go.
That's
good.
That's good.
All right.
Okay, we're going to take a break. About a 5-10 minute break. Gotta get something to drink and use the little boys or little girls' room. Let's go ahead and do it. When I get started, I won't stop. Okay? Is that okay?
He's worse than me.
I'll pull my pocket for it.
I'm not a rat.
Any coffee? You got the
party?
Yes.
Actually, yes.
I don't know exactly what
you're
doing.
All right, I got a special guest. I want you to meet. Friend of mine, and I'm going to let him speak for himself. This is Dr. Mark Sibley. He's from the Florida Eye Center in St. Pete, and he's just going to share a little bit with you guys of what he does.
Well,
and for the record, he's doing my eyes. So I'll let you know. If I come in like this, but you know what? I've heard great things.
Don't mess with Mom.
Well, thank you, Michael. That was a great introduction, and I'm glad to be your invited guest today. I met Michael 2 weeks ago, and we were talking about some business opportunities and some business deals. I'm an ophthalmologist, and that's a medical doctor who does 4 more years of eye surgery and laser training. And when you hear about the miracles of restoring vision with corneal transplants or the new things like Tiger Woods has with his LASIK to throw away your glasses. I'm the eye doctor for the Tampa Bay Rays. We're their LASIK doctor. And in fact, I knew where Ramada Inn was in spite of your wrong address. Because my LASIK center is a couple blocks away. Everybody on West Shore knows the drive-in Starbucks. I'm next to the drive-in Starbucks with the LASIK Center there. So thank you for allowing me to join and to be part of this. And I look forward to participating and share your enthusiasm.
All right.
Hey, Doc, you got a card?
Yes.
I do.
Okay.
and have one for you, Willie.
There you go.
What's the difference between an ophthalmologist and an optometrist?
That's a really good question. The difference between an ophthalmologist and an optometrist, Mark.
A common question and a common misunderstanding. In fact, we did a poll and only about 10% of the public knows the difference. Who thinks they know the difference? All right. I'm not going to call on anybody, but I'm an ophthalmologist, and an ophthalmologist went through medical school. And then after 4 years of medical school, I did 4 years of eye surgery. Some of us even go years more and specialize in certain aspects. An optometrist goes through college and goes through his 4 years of medical, his 4 years of optometric training. Now, when he graduates and goes out into practice, he's an eye doctor, I'm an eye doctor. My mother always said, this is Dr. Sibley, my son, the eye doctor. So she called me an eye doctor too, but optometrists prescribe glasses, they do exams, they can treat glaucoma, they can make a diagnosis and treat pink eye, but when you need a specialist and you need surgery, it's the ophthalmologist. But here's a recommendation, get your eyes examined.
That's right.
Thank you.
Wherever you go.
Awesome.
Well, eye exams should be on a regular basis. Some people don't need to start until they turn about 40 and start getting short arms. But if you have medical problems, diabetes, blood pressure, cholesterol,
headaches,
blurry
vision.
Doc, why don't you just be quiet for a minute?
He's saying it.
Or anything runs in your family. And unfortunately, glaucoma is more than 10 times more frequent in African Americans, and glaucoma has no pain or pus or poor vision until it's too late. So everybody with brown eyes has more chance of macular degeneration, of glaucoma. Everybody with blue eyes has more chance of macular degeneration. I said it right that time. So if you have blue eyes, you got to be seen for macular degeneration. If you have brown eyes, you have to be seen for glaucoma.
And if you have blue eyes,
it compounds you get both. Diabetic.
Yes.
If you have black eyes,
no,
don't make
no
your wife mad.
It's
Deborah Flanagan? Never heard of her.
You're good. That's my idea.
I think she had a question.
Whoa, that's not good.
Oh, I don't need this. I'm already late.
Somebody will come. Anybody out there?
Do you have a phone?
No. Sorry. Somebody! Hello! There are two people stuck on an escalator and we need help. Now, would somebody please do something? I don't believe this. You gotta be kidding me.
I'm gonna cry.
Well, there's not enough left to do, is there?
Hello? Hey, don't worry about it. I'll fix it in a second.
He said he can fix it. All right. All right. That's more like it.
God.
He says he can fix it.
we get stuck. We get stuck sometimes in life, in place where we think we can't do it. Okay? Everybody knows the saying, you gotta think outside the box. I want you to get rid of the box. Because if you do, everybody has heard, if you do what you've done, you're gonna get what you got. Alright? So you gotta do something different. Obviously, my focus is on real estate. I got 22 years working as an administrator in a law firm. And so I learned a lot of things along the way. I want to be able to show you how to get on the other side of the table. When I went to a closing table, the law firm got, I don't know, $1,500, $2,500, $3,000. And the guy signing the papers got a check for, I don't know, $100,000, $200,000, $1 million. So I learned how to get on the other side of the table. When I first started doing my real estate, I started just like everybody else. I would just do a single family home. And I would work on it for 3 to 6 months to make $200-$300 a month after that. I don't call that retirement. I call that working hard. And there's nothing wrong with working hard. What I want to teach you today is how to work smarter, earn more. You saw the video in the beginning. I want to retire in 7 to 10 years. Starting today, I don't care where you're at, whether you're up here or it's just starting out all over again because life has beat you and you're just getting up, I'm going to show you how to retire in 7 to 10 years. Obviously, no recording. We say that because we don't want somebody saying that I said something that I didn't say. The information I'm giving you is intended as educational. I'm not giving you any legal advice. I'm not giving you any financial advice. I'm not giving you any kind of advice, and definitely not giving you any marital advice. Networking is great. We just met the doctor. Anybody that has a problem with their I was gonna say with the head, but he doesn't deal with the head. Different doctor, I'll bring him next week. But anybody that had fun with the eyes, definitely. And I'll give you an update. Yes?
Sorry to cut you off, Mike. But the video, what happened? And it's cut off on us.
That's it. It's basically, that was the end of the video where they just stood there and did nothing. They did nothing, which is what we do in life. We do nothing.
Okay.
Feel free to pass out your cards, talk to each other, get involved. Feel free to ask questions of those that are involved with us in projects. They'll tell you. If I ask for some testimonials, I mean, I know a couple back there that they're excited, you know, and they just got their new car since they got started with us, and they took it out on a long trip out to Jacksonville. He's one of our new administrators for one of the assisted living facilities that we put together. I could go on and on, Celso and Yara and everybody that we're doing the projects that we have a lot going on. We're Investors Mentorship Club. All I want to say is that education is not preparation for life. John Dewey said that education is life itself. The more you know. You know, we don't do the things that we don't know because we haven't been trained. I promise you, I watch a lot of TLC, and if I watch the doctor do his surgery, which I wouldn't because obviously it would be against the law, but if I watch him do a surgery on LASIK, enough times, I would try. Of course, I'm not going to do that. I'm just saying, one time, let me share with you. One time, I got a 3-inch gash on one leg. Don't ask me how, because it's embarrassing. But I got a 3-inch gash, and I went to the doctor, and I was sitting. He's been my doctor for 5 years. And while I'm sitting and he's cleaning me up to stitch me up, my wife is talking to him, and he's cold turkey. He just sewed me right up and then charged me $250. Well, about a year and a half later, I cut the other leg up, 2-inch gash. And I said, No, I'm doing this on myself. I keep my own children. My wife says, are you kidding? I go, no. I stitch myself up. Because that's I'm just the drive that I have, the motivation to do things. Some, I'm not going to perform my own heart surgery or anything like that, so relax, okay? But this is the thing, though. I wanted to teach you guys how to do things, how to try. But if you go to school for 8 years, then you can do what Dr. Sibley is doing. You can, or you could retire in the next 7-10 years without going to college. Now, please, I'm not knocking education. I love it. Education is life itself. The more you know, the more you do. The more you learn, the more you'll try. So you got to do something. You know, we say you got to get in the game with us. We're just going to grasp the old and make it new. I said we did real estate. When I first started out, I did my first house, and I was excited. And most of you heard the story that I took my wife the information on the house, and she said, oh, absolutely not. This was in 1994. She said, no, because we were going to take our entire life savings, all 2,000 of them, okay, and we were going to put it in a down payment in our first owner finance home. And she said, no, I don't think so. And I said, well, because we had this agreement in the marriage that anything over $500, we would discuss it. And $2,000 is over $500, so I had to discuss it with her. I should have broken it up into $499. But anyways, so I did, and she said, no, I don't think so. And all night long, I said to myself, self, you got to do this. This is your first opportunity of doing your first real estate investment. And so the next day, I called the guy back up after I had told him that I couldn't do it and because my wife didn't want to do it. He said, because he had a really course.
I told you, you said your wife didn't want to do it.
I said, yes, she don't, but I'm going to do it anyways.
He said, well, you know that's going to cost you trouble.
I said, yeah, I know that. I said, but this is one of those things that I have to do. How many of you have said, you know what, I'm going to do this, and you go to a friend or a family member, and they go, are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. You can't do that. You're going to fail. Or, no, you can't do that. Well, I have quite a few of those in my family, too. I've kind of won them over in the last 10 years. But that's what happens. We call those dream stealers. Because they don't see that there's anything else there for them. It's nothing bad. You know, the mechanic will teach his kid how to work on cars. The carpenter will teach their kids how to work on, and usually the doctors will want it, right? Not that they'll always do it, but that's what happens. Oh, yes, my son's a doctor. I'm like, do you have any children that are doctors?
Yes.
Okay. So you mean none of your kids are mechanics or carpenters or anything? You know why? Because he's a doctor. Great, huh? Now, every now and then you get a rebel that goes in a different direction. That's okay. It's called life. But what we want to do is teach you the techniques that work, not what everybody else is doing. And you buy a kit like that and you don't do anything with it, or you copycat somebody that does, like my first house. It was a single family home. Well, let me get back to the story where, so I did buy the property and I did sleep in the sofa for about 2 weeks. It was lonely, I admit that. But I won her over. This is the thing though. Yes, you can go and somebody said to me, well, there's a workshop and it's gonna teach me how to buy a house, rehab it, sell it, and flip it. There is. There's one today, there's one next week. There's gonna be one every week. That's great. I know two guys. I share the story of these two guys that I personally know. One's in the late 20s and one's in their early 30s. One in their early 30s is worth about $2.2, $2.3 million. They're partners. The other one's worth about $1.6, $1.8. They have these properties and they do 3 to 5 every month. Every month. They buy a house, they put together a team, and they go and they work on it. And then they sell it and make a little bit of money. How many of you would say that buying a property that's worth $100 and you bought it for $75 and there's a $75,000 profit is a good deal.
Yeah.
Right? If you took $75,000 and you left it in the bank, you'd make about 1%. The equivalent's about $750. If you put it in your money market, you make about 3%, 3 to 4%. The equivalent's of about $3,000. But if you took that $75,000 and you put it in that house that I just said, and you made $25,000, that sounds like a good deal, doesn't it? I got some accountants here. Would they say it's a good deal? Yeah, he's been around me too long. No. No, it's not a good deal. You take $75,000, you buy a house, you put $10,000 in it, you're now up to $85,000, you sell it for $100,000, you say, well, I made $15,000. What about your other partner? Because you got a partner.
Uncle Sam.
Obama. The government. The IRS man, right? That's your other partner. To the tune of at least 19.9%. So you gotta make it right, make it work. So you go back to my two friends and they do 3 to 5 every month. That's a lot of work. Raise your hand if you've worked on a rehab, on any kind of building project, whether you owned it or not. Pretty much almost everybody. It's a lot of work. And that's okay if there's an end to it, but if there's no end, 3 to 5 properties, let's just average it at 4. Isn't that 48 homes in 1 year? Now that's great. There's a tax consequence, and there's a labor, and for how long? They've been doing it for 11 to 12 years. In 11 to 12 years, they live a comfortable life, but they've amassed $2 million average. Not bad. Most of you will earn $1 million. I want to do it every year. Is that okay?
It's okay by me.
Right? Our goal is simply to take you to a higher level. I want to go ahead and teach you how to do that same work. Just we don't want to do 3 to 5 every year without it changing. I want to do it for 7 to 10 years. Our strategy is to mentor the student until they get to the point where they can do it themselves. Maybe if I watch enough time, maybe, and assure the success of all the investors. What is the biggest fear of investing?
Losing money.
Losing.
How do we get rid of it? How many of you have money invested in whatever it is, any investment out there, whether it's a dollar or $100 million, and a third party as controller? I have some of those too. Only 15% of what I own is involved in somebody else's hand. Stock market. I have 15% of what I own in stock market. Do you know I have no control over that? None. Zero. I get up in the morning, and if something happened in China, I'm going, what does that have to do with me? It does. I'm connected to it. So what I want to do is something that we control. The last time, 2 weeks ago, we had a seminar, small meeting. You all learned about self-directed IRAs, right? Mm-hmm. Who does not know what a self-directed IRA is? It's okay. So you don't have to raise your hand. That's okay. A self-directed IRA. You direct the IRA what you want it to do. Okay, and in 2 weeks, Scott Maurer from Advanta IRA will also be teaching us a little bit more about that. It is one of the most powerful tools. Two tools you need. Three things, actually. You need William Crowley to help you with the credit. Or it doesn't have to be him. It could be anybody. We're not promoting just one thing. I'm using them. You need credit. You need funding. Next month, I have a gentleman coming to provide private money, not hard money, private money for us, 10 to 12%. He wants to get involved with us, and I think that'll be good. Plus, you need the education to learn what to do. We want you to participate. You've got to get in the game. You have to. I want an action or a reaction. It's up to you. The problem is that some of you will hear me all year long and keep telling yourselves, yeah, I could do this. I'm going to do this. I'm almost ready. I met one lady. How many of you heard of what they call them, seminar junkies? I have one lady called Seminar Sandy. She's dumped over $120,000 in seminars and materials and books and videos, but she hasn't bought one piece of property. She'd have been better off to take the $120,000 over the course of a year and a half, put it in a Roth IRA, and just sit it out. She says, when I saw her about 7 or 8 months, she says, Mike, I'm almost there. I'm just determining which deal I'm going to do. She was going to do a storage facility with me. And the day before closing, she said, you know, I can't do it yet. We bought, sold it, flipped it, and made tons of money on it. She said, oh, I was that close. What we want you to do is be a participator. We want you to be part owner. We want you to be on the board. You know what? Sometimes board meetings are boring. That's why I call them board meetings. But they're necessary. We want to get you involved so you can know what's going on. Teamwork. It makes the dream. Together we can do this. Once we get in the game. My plan is simple. It's a 7-year, not a plan. It's a 7-year plan. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to, this is actually a secret meeting about plants. So I'm going to teach about agriculture. But it's a, I did my own spell checking. Right? Our mentorship is simple. You must duplicate your efforts. I want to do the 3 to 5 projects just like my friends. The difference is I want to duplicate the effort and multiply it by itself every year for the next 7 to 10 years. Can I really retire in 7 years? I don't know, it's up to you. You know, William said something before, and he said, you gotta do what I say. You know, can I stop for 1 second? My wife said to me yesterday I looked at three properties. The smallest one, the least expensive that I looked at, was a 170-bed facility that's worth how much, Angie?
When purchased originally?
170. How much is it worth right now?
Seven.
Not 1,000. 900,000. $7 million. That's the smallest project I looked at yesterday. If you'd have told me that 17 years ago, I would have said, not happening. How many of you drive by a building, a skyscraper, and never say, wow, I can own that?
Yeah.
I can own that. I can literally own that. Most of you don't even look that way. Because you don't think, you know, I can't do it. How many of you, I'm going to pick on you, Mark, you know that, right? How many of you, when you were kids, you said, yeah, I'm going to be a doctor, or I'm going to be a lawyer? And then, as you grew up and your counselor said, well, yes, that'd be great. All right, you'd make an incredible doctor. However, you got to go to school for this many years, and you got to go to school for that many years, and then you have to do this. And yeah, is there anything easier? You're like, bus driver or something? Oh, yes, we could teach you that in 2 weeks, or a truck driver or something. Because we want the easy way out. How many of you know that we want easy? We want to pull into the first window. Can I take your order? Yes, I'll give you my order, and 15 seconds later, I want my order, I would be gone, and I'm going to be eating.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, how we want it. But you know how many times we're going to do that? All our life. All our life, we're going to do that. And we're going to settle for that. Some of us will pull into the parking lot of a nice restaurant, sit down, and enjoy the meal, and it'll be a better meal. An action and a reaction in everything you do in life. So I want you to do different. I want you to look at the building and go, you know, what about this hotel? I don't know, what's it worth though? 20 million?
30 million?
How many of you think that you can own this? Today, right now, how many of you think that you can own one of these?
Right now.
Why don't you look around? You know why? Now, when I met these folks, none of them raised their hand. Because it just wasn't, they just, even the doctor, without that LASIK machine, hey, does that really cut through paper? even without the right tools, he can't do what he does. Am I right?
Right.
He showed me some incredible equipment in his office. I mean, I wanted to get on and play with it, but he was there, so I couldn't do it, right? And I said, I'm not leaving this guy alone in my office. But if you have the right equipment, the right tools, you can do anything. And so what I'm doing is going to equip you with the right information, the right tools, so you can do the right deals. Now, do I want you to go out and try to do one of those skyscrapers, $200 million deals this week?
No.
Absolutely not. I want you to think about this. You can do this in 30 days, 30 months, or 30 years. It's completely up to you. I want to do it in 7 to 10 years. I'm not teaching you a theory. I'm teaching you what I've done in my life. Some of you have been around me long enough to see that I have had some successes. Some of you I've helped. Some of you I'm starting to help out. And some of you are just getting started. There is one thing, one caveat. I do everything 1 year at a time. Recently, you know, I teach people on assisted living facilities. He's not here? No, he's not. Recently, about as recent as 2.5 months ago, I had one gentleman come to one of our seminars, ask me a lot of questions about an assisted living facility, and I knew what he was doing. He was going to try to play with that equipment himself. And you know what he did? He went and put a bid for an assisted living facility. I told him, listen, what you want to do is you want to go through my boot camp and you want to go and take the state test and you want to get familiarized with it before you try it. And so what he did was he got two people from our class, three of them got together, and they did a group venture. And they bought the property and they took over the assisted living facility and they took over the lady's license.
No.
And he self-appointed himself as the administrator. She said she would coach him for about 2 months. She was out of there 2 weeks later. Akka showed up, said, who are you? I'm the administrator. Akka said, oh no, you're not. And they closed him down. So he calls me up and says, Mike, I don't know what happened. I was doing everything like I was. I said, I told you could not take over that lady's license. He says, well, what am I, they empty the building now, 14 beds. And, he said, what am I going to do? He said, are you interested? I said, no, it's empty. What would I be interested? I said, why don't you wait? Because he was in a hurry. He pulled up to the first window, he heard the information, and wanted 15 seconds later how to do it. If that's what you want, I'm not the guy for you. One of the things that I learned, and I learned from my dad, he said, son, the best thing that God did was one day right after the other. And there's no way around it. You're going to live them. How many, I don't know, but you're gonna live days. So we're gonna do stuff 1 year at a time. This is my theory. Some of you will work for 30, 40 years to a company, you become faithful to them, and then they become unfaithful to you. They dump you, that's what they do. They have to sometimes. Don't take it personal, they say, it's a business deal.
Yeah.
It's a business. I'm glad that you gave me 40 years of your life, and you made it possible for us to get to work. But now we have to change things. So what I want to do is I'm going to show you how many of you do not know about whether I gave you, let's say I gave you $100,000 today to invest in a piece of property, and I gave you a check for $100,000. Or I gave you the option to take a dollar, duplicate it by itself for the next 30 days. Which one would you take? Doctor, which one would you take? I'm going to give you $100,000 or a dollar, and I'm going to duplicate it by itself for the next 30 days.
Has it doubled each day?
It doubles by itself each day for the next 30 days.
I'm pretty sure I'm going to take your dollar.
You're going to take my dollar. How many else? How many would not take the ballot? She says it's 100,000. How many would not take the dollar? Raise your hand if you would not take the dollar. Okay. If you duplicate a dollar, let me ask one of my accountant. Yara, how much money, if I gave you a dollar and I duplicate it by itself for the next 30 days, how much money do you think it is in the next 30 days? She says it's going to be over 100,000. I'm going to show you how much money it's going to be. If I take a dollar.
Isn't it 12.8 million, something like that?
What is it?
It's over 12 million.
Over 12 million. It's way over 12 million. If you take a dollar and you double it by itself for the next 30 days, if I double it for 10 days, it's $512 for 10 days. If I double that dollar for the next 10 more days, on the 20th day, it's $512,000. If I double it for 10 more days by itself, it's $512 million.
Yeah, you say that way, it's different.
Double it by itself.
See, I don't understand the by itself.
English is a second language for me.
Okay.
So is eye surgery.
Third language.
If you square each number,
double
if you
each
square
day.
Is
double
a different
each.
Thing than
okay.
One times one.
Double,
is,
double
one times
by
two
itself.
Is one times two.
Yeah. Double it each day for the next day.
Got it.
So what I want to do is this. Some of you take, some of you have a traditional, actually most of you will have a traditional 401k.
No, it's not a square. It is a
double.
It is a double.
It is a double.
Yeah, it's not a square.
Double.
Some of you will take your traditional 401k and you contribute to it and your employer will double it and you're so happy because at the end of the year you put away $10,000 or $20,000 or $100,000. And then you're so happy because you then did the math and you've calculated that in the next 35, 40 years, you'll be able to be at a number that you figured you can live with for the rest of your life. So if I ask people, Pretty, how much money do you need for retirement?
$1 million.
$1 million. That's a fair number, all right? Now check this out. You can reach $1 million in 3 or 4 years. But if I retire her in 3 or 4 years, she's gonna come back and say, Mike, listen, life's changed. I got more expenses, you know, I got all these dates to go to and spend money. And so I need $2 million. Chris, how much money do you need to retire right now?
$2,700 a month.
$2,700 a month. He could be retired in 90 days if he wants. But do you think his life is going to change in 90 days? Oh yeah, he's going to have a lot of free time. He's going to say, Mike, I need more money. So I'm going to teach you, A, to pick a number and pick a time. And then I'm going to tell you from here to here, every year takes 364 days. It's actually 364 and a quarter day, isn't it?
Right.
Mm-hmm. 364 days. And then we're going to take that, we're going to take your $5,000 this year. Let's say, how many of you have been to my assisted living in Seminole? A few of you. You've never been there? Okay. Yeah, about half of you have been to my assisted living in Largo, Seminole, the 20 bed. Okay, let's say we're going to put together a facility like that one, and it costs us over $800,000. I think we've invested about close to $900,000. And we have, 24 people here? And let's say that I found a facility like that and I needed, $300,000. Between all of us here, let's assume 24, 25 people, that we each did $10,000, $12,000. And then we took that facility, and we all worked with it. And then we doubled that facility, but we all owned it, and I trained you all, and we all worked together. And we basically did this. We took your $5,000 this year to $10,000. Is that easy to do? Can we take $5,000 to $10,000 in 1 year?
Yeah.
It's pretty simple, right? And we follow that. So year one, we would take your individual investment and double it every year by itself on the eighth year, if all she did was invest $5,000 with us in a group, she can retire in 8 years. What about if you start here? Can you live with $4 million? What I'm teaching you is not a theory. This is what I've done. It's just duplication at work. Instead of a dollar, it'll be whatever you, wherever you're at. This is why I say everybody can get involved. Some people may say to me, Mike, you have no idea what life has done to me.
Yeah.
You want to trade war stories? I come from the Bronx. I joke around. We tell people that we were so poor, we would pray to God that a burglar would break into our house so we could rob it. We wouldn't. But my mom and dad worked really hard. And there's nothing wrong with hard work. We'll take our plan and we'll just double the money every year, no matter where the money is at. But it's critical. You must do. Willie, you have to do what I tell you. So I had one student that said to me, she invested $25,000, and she's not here. We were too slow for her. She said, I want to do it assisted living. Okay, week two, she came back and said, Mike, you and I got enough money, we can go ahead and do 100-bed facility, okay? She said, I got X money. Okay, she brought her husband with her that day because he wasn't with her the first day. And he said, we can, at the most three people. So in other words, she wanted to cut all you guys out except me and maybe one more. That's not what this is about. And I said, that's great. Which one of us is going to run the facility? She said, well, you, of course. Because she had no experience doing it. I said, well, that sounds like a job. I'm not trying to. I said, no, what you do is you go through year one, and we do the 10-bed facility that we're going to do, and then we're going to do a 20-bed, and then we'll do a 40-bed. Because we're going to double the money, we're going to double the effort, we're going to double the value of these properties. We're not going to go from a 6-bed to a 100-bed in 1 month. Not going to happen. What would happen to half of the people in here, if you won the lotto, all of you just won the lotto, $90 million, and the government took its 40%, 39.9% off the bat, right, leaves what, 56, and then you pay your personal taxes at 19.9, and it leaves you with about $34 million, and it clears your account in 30 days. What do you think will happen to half of you?
Wind up broke.
In how long? We're talking a good
a
chunk.
A year or
30,
two.
32 million. No, it's going to take a little longer for you to blow $32 million.
Depends on how.
How long do you think it would take to blow $32 million?
Two and a half to 5 years.
About 4 to 5 years. Yeah. You'll be dead broke again.
But happy.
You'll never again.
When you broke.
Never again will you find happiness again. If you get $32 million and you're blowing, you're going to always try to get there. But how about this? How about you learn secrets of the millionaires, tax strategies, about your foundations, about your charitable remainder trust, all your tax strategies, and how to write everything off so that you can keep it. Would you be better if you were disciplined? I think so. You know, we talk about buying million-dollar properties with, you know, 10%, 20%. If I said, hey, I got a building that we could buy with zero down, and we need $200,000 to buy it. Some of you have heard the example, right? Mm-hmm. How many of you think you can't buy this building today? It's a million-dollar build, $2 million building, 100 units, and you need 10% down, $200,000. How many of you cannot do this right now, individually? Cannot do it. How many of you cannot do it? See, the thing is, again, knowing how to do it. Every one of you in here can do it. This is real simple. If you, it's not simple. How about I find you a building that's $2 million? Well, Mike, we need $200,000 down. We don't have it. Have you seen my bank account? It's down to like $1,000. Okay. How about this? You got $1,000 in your bank. You give a $500 deposit. Just earn this money deposit just to sign a contract. In 30 days, we say we're going to give them another $10,000 or $20,000. They're happy with it. And there's 100 units, and this is in Tampa, nice area of Tampa. And each apartment's $1,000. How many of you have done a closing and seen a HUD statement? How many of you do not know what a HUD statement is? A HUD statement is a statement that says, this is the buyer's side, and this is the seller's side, and this is what you're going to get, and this is what you got to give up. Right? And you see the both sides. So we have 100 units at $1,000 a piece. What day of the month is today? The 20th? Mm-hmm. If I signed a contract today, I would tell the seller that I would close this deal on the 5th of the month. This month, I can close that deal, but all I have is $1,000 in my bank. How are we going to do this?
The 5th of May or the 5th of April?
The 5th of the next month. Okay. That'll be May.
All right.
Yeah, maybe. I can't go back. So
no.
I
didn't think so.
Okay. Well, no, I know so. We can't go back. We can go forward. So we're going to close on the 5th.
Predated?
No, we're going to close on May the 5th on this project. I'm going to teach you all how to find one. Now, they're very rare, but they're there. And I'm going to teach you that you can do this. And then I'm going to teach you how we take this effort and put it as a group, and we grow 1, 2, 4, 8, $16 million at a time. So we have 100 units at $1,000. We're going to close on the 5th. Somebody tell me why we're going to close on the 5th.
I read it.
All the deposits on hold. Escrow account.
On that settlement statement on this side, they have to give me a credit for every one of those rents. How many rents is that? 100 of them. And how much are the rents? How much is that? Is that $100,000? That goes on my side. And then deposits. At 100 deposits. In some cases, you even have security deposits. About a third or half of the rent. So that would be another $100,000. And the seller's going, wait a minute. I didn't count all that. No, that's not my problem. That's his problem. He thought he was going to walk away. He owes $750,000 on the building. He figured, I'm going to walk away with $250,000. Knowledge is power. If he didn't do his homework and he didn't have his accountant ready, that's not my problem. And if he doesn't have the money escrow, it's a problem for him. If he's got an escrow, it's no big deal. He's still going to get his $200,000. So then we have these things called other escrows, like what? Taxes? So let's say the taxes are $24,000 a year. All right, $24,000 for a $2 million property. So we're in the month of April, so we're averaging $2,000 a month, so we would get another $16,000 on our side. Does everybody see that? Who does not see that? So I can break it down. Okay, so you have taxes. Your annual taxes are $24,000 a year, property taxes. Well, they're going to prorate it. Okay. And they're going to prorate, and for the next 8 months, they're going to put that much on my side. What do you think the insurance for a property like that is? I don't know. $12,000, $14,000? Let's just say $12,000. Probably a little bit more because I pay, how much do you pay insurance for that property in Brooksville?
$28,000.
So I'm gonna let's say
so it's liability. That's
it. Okay. So let's say it's $20,000 for insurance.
What a month?
Hmm?
A month.
A year.
A year.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's another 12,000, 14,000. You actually close on this deal, and if they have any escrows or anything else they got to put on your side, you take your $1,000, you keep it in your bank account, you close on this deal and walk away with about $24,000, $25,000. And the seller's going, what happened? But let's say that the seller is a little smarter and he's not going to fall for that. He wants to close it on the 31st of the month. And they are. I tried, I put these contracts, they go, no, I want to close on the 31st. Between all of us here, you think we could come up with $200,000? Now, how soon can we get our money back out? If I said, okay, how much you got? And we got up $225,000 with closing costs to close on this deal, how fast can we get our money back?
3 to 6 months.
How long? On the 5th of the next month. We have deposits. Okay, so before all those examples, some of you said, yeah, I can't do the $2 million deal. How many of you can do the $2 million deal now?
All right. I have a question.
Knowledge is power.
But if it already has inheritance, aren't they exempt from the deposit because they're already living there?
Yes, but the seller?
Is not.
If I'm selling to you, that money, I can't keep it. Mm. I have to give it up to the new buyer. So that if everybody wants to move out on the 6th, I'm supposed to be able to. So now it's not out of your reach. Like an assisted living facility. That's the one we own. 20 beds. Hotel. I mean, we could go on and on and on. What I want to do is coach you. I want to coach you for the next 7 to 10 years, 1 year at a time. Is that okay? Or you guys can go to Dean Graziosi, or you can go to Armando Montalongo. How many have never heard of those names? Right, okay, that's what I said. And you could pay them $20,000, $25,000, and they will mentor you for about 2 weeks. Am I right?
Yes.
2 weeks. You can get on the phone, and you say, hey, listen, I paid $20,000, $25,000, so you guys can coach me. And they go, great, what do you got going on? We'll help you with it. No, I want you to help me put it. No, it doesn't work that way. What you do is you go find a deal, and we'll tell you how to put it together. And they do that for about 2 weeks. Oh, but I thought you were going to help me. And you were, yes. Oh, what you want is the advanced classes where we actually help you and put it together. Okay, that's another $25,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're going, wow, that didn't work out for me. What I'm talking about is we go and we pick up the building. And we go and we clean it up and we paint it up and we put it together. And how many of you are doing projects like that with us right now? Raise your hand. And we go out and do it. And we duplicate our efforts. Now, are we going to teach Dr. Mark Sibley? How long have you been a doctor?
35 years.
Are we going to teach him how to do drywall?
No.
Unless he wants to.
What?
Unless he wants to.
No.
Tile. No. We use people in their capacity.
I'll pass out the safety glasses.
There you go. Okay, and you know what? Some of us have somebody that did it for us. Because we can't. All right? What we do is we teach you how to do everything from A to Z in a project, whatever it is. We have board meetings. You find out what's going on, keep you in the loop. Documents, how to do them, work on them, get copies. In the first year, this is what's going to happen. Everyone's going to participate in 4 projects. And let's just say you got started with $25,000 or $10,000 or whatever. You pick your number. Does that mean for every project? No. I can thankfully say in the last 7-8 years, I've never done a capital call. Hey, we need more money. No, we don't. Because what we've done is we've put together a little system that works this way. What we want to do is secure your money. We want to save money. We're going to use the same money for all the projects. You won't need more capital. The projects will already be funded. Everyone will have an equity interest ownership of up to 100% of their investment. Everyone will participate in the board, on the board. Everyone will learn how to do it and repeat it so that you don't have to depend on me or anybody else ever again. I'm going to teach you how to do it, and you're going to repeat it. It's a win-win-win for everybody. First year results, and I don't know anybody that can assure this, 25 to 100% return on your money. Secure with real estate. It teaches you how to do rehabs, find them, acquire, resell them. Sharpens your skills on the things that you already know how to do. Prepares you for the second year transaction. No capital calls. More results, it provides us with a group property for our group portfolio. Some of you, if I just taught you and you took property and put it in your name, you would sell it within a year. Some of you would just get rid of it. Somebody would say, I had, at the Pier Hotel, you met at the hotel. Most of you have been there. I've had people offer me $2 million, $2.2 million. The last offer I had was $2.6 million. My wife said, why don't you? I said, because I don't want to sell. Because $2.6 million is not $2.6 million. It's whatever the tax man says it is. If you think that paying, how many of you work overtime? Let's say I just had somebody who said to me, man, I'm making $20, my sister in Connecticut, I'm making $20 an hour extra just on overtime. Really? I said, now calculate, what was the difference between your check for 40 hours and, she said, oh. And she lives in Connecticut. She says she's smarter than me. She lives in the second highest tax state. And she loves working overtime for her partner, the governor. The projects just grow the next year. So if we did a 6-bed facility that costs $350,000 to put together and run and operate, next year would be a $750,000. The year after that would be a $1 million or $1.5 million. The year after that would be a $3 million property. The year after that, because everything has to double.
I'm going to go through this here.
This is the thing. What are you doing to get there? If all you're doing is what you've done, that's what you're going to get. That's my grandson and my son John. He's a little older now. Now, what I want to do is I want to keep going. We could take a 10-minute break, or I could keep going and spin right through this. What do you say? Keep going? Okay, great. But if you need to take a break, please feel free to do so. Most of you have met with me one-on-one. Some of you have not. And then I break it down for you guys and show you how I take, on every year, I do 4 to 5 projects. One of the projects that I use, if this is your first year doing investing, obviously you don't have any tax breaks. So you do a home-based business so you can get tax breaks. An example that I give is
you should have done the taxes.
If you haven't, and I hope you did an extension, but if you have your taxes and you don't have all the tax strategies and tax breaks that you have from a corporation, then you're missing out. You should be able to have all kind of write-offs, so your car and your phone and your food and your clothing and everything. And that's one of my fortes. I'm writing off pretty much everything in life, everything. Vacations, even cruises. How many of you know that cruises are not tax deductible?
Vessels are. Vessels are.
You've been around me. Cruises are not tax deductible, but if this is our board meeting and this week we decided that we want to have our annual board meeting in Mexico, we would jump on a cruise, get off the cruise in Mexico, walk down to Felipe's burrito shop down the boat there, right here. Eat, take a picture, have our minutes, come back, and we would write it off as transportation to our board meeting. Did not know that that is possible. Believe me, you could travel all over the world for free. If you're not involved with this is a good piece of advice. You could write a book. If you wrote a book on how to travel the world on a poor man's budget, you don't have to publish it. You have to bind it. You could write off every one of those locations that you go to and get it back. I mean, there's just so many tax breaks. I actually can give you about 200 tax breaks. That
question. Actually, it means you bind it. You mean just kind of, you don't have to get it published, but if you, I assume you have to actually just write it.
You have to write it and have to bound, like you have the IRS looks at the intent of things.
Okay, as if you fit the intent.
Let me explain, if you don't understand, fully understand. So I say, Harold, I'll meet you at the Starbucks, right down the street from the office here, from the Optical Center. What is it, off of,
on West Shore.
Right on West Shore, this way. Yeah. And we'll just catch up. I haven't seen you for 3 months. And I go there and I buy him a cup of coffee. What kind of coffee do you drink at Starbucks?
Mocha.
What is it?
Mocha.
Okay, simple one. Okay. Vanilla latte for me. Grande. Skim milk. Yeah, skinny. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. That just makes us feel good, right? Yeah, okay. And so I spend, and I have a pastry there. We spend $13. Is that tax deductible? No. That is not tax deductible. Because I said to him, man, I haven't seen you like in forever. I'll meet you there after my seminar. We can get kind of catch up.
Yeah, but you said the IRS wants us to look at intent.
What was my intent?
Socialize.
But I say to you, listen, what I'm doing is a seminar. I would love to talk to you about it. Meet you at Starbucks. We have the same thing, $13, tax deductible. And you receive that right now. Once we talk business, how's your wife and kids doing, and so on? We can do that afterwards. It's all about intent. Once I teach you how to make the money, then I'm going to teach you how to keep the money. Keep the money. More important to keep it than it is to make it. If you learn how to make money, you're going to be so busy making it that you're going to lose it because you don't know how to keep it. So I want to teach you a foundation on how to keep it. And one of the things you're going to learn is about doing less taxes and more deductions. The IRS says you can pay taxes now, later, and never. I like the never part. Legally. How many of you know that if you don't pay your taxes legally, you end up like Wesley Snipes? So don't get the idea that, you know, it's unconstitutional, blah, blah, blah. Perhaps it is. But if you don't pay it, I promise you, they'll give you accommodations at Club Fed. So what we want to do is we want to pay our taxes, but we want to pay as little as possible. Okay? So we're going to teach you a little bit about less taxes and more deductions. We're talking about tax strategies, real estate professional versus real estate dealer. How many of you know the difference between the two? A couple of you. Real estate professional versus real estate dealer. One of those two you do not want to be, not unless you like the IRS. Now, some of us, unfortunately, fall into both categories. Now, let me explain that I can be a real estate professional and be a real estate dealer at the same time. You just have to keep them separate, in separate entities. I do that. Fortunately, I have, and unfortunately, I have both. These are my tax strategies. Before the IRS determines whether you're a real estate investor, dealer, or professional, they want to know, why did you buy it? What was the purpose? Again, intent. What was the intent you had when you bought that property? What are the facts and circumstances why you bought it? And the application for investors is the whole property as inventory. A real estate dealer is going to hold it.
So I buy a property, I buy it today for $75,000, I put $5,000 and I sell it next month. And I made, $20,000, $30,000. Are you a real estate professional or are you a real estate dealer? You're a dealer, but you did not keep it for at least a year and a day. Can you be a dealer and still keep it for a year and a day?
Yeah.
Sure. You still can't have the deduction.
Now, usually this applies to fixing and flipping property, especially for taxpayers. It's the worst, and I'm going to explain to you why. The IRS will observe your pattern in determining your intent. If your intent was to fix it, rehab it, and sell it, they're going to say, that's great. So let me give you an example. Let's say we bought a piece of property for $60,000. That's a good deal, and it's worth $100,000. And you put $20,000 in it, and you sold it for $100,000 a month later. And then you did your taxes, and you spend carpet, paint, kitchen, whatever, $20,000, and you try to expense, write it off as a credit, $20,000, you cannot. The maximum you can write off is $3,000. Because you're a real estate dealer. If you're a real estate professional for that same property, you can write off the $20,000. Is that big? That's huge. Let's go back to the apartment complex. You say, well, you know, it's not really that much. It's $17,000. It's not going to change my life. I didn't need the $100,000. I sold it and I got it. Yeah, but people, this is the problem. That if you close on that property, at that moment, you got a $100,000 check in your hand. And you're thinking, I'm good. Who cares what the tax man says? You either pay it now or you pay it later. And if you're really sharp, you pay it never. I like never. You say, yeah, but I got the money in my hand. It's here. I know it's here. It's okay. The problem is that you're not going to write a $17,000 check that week to the IRS, so you don't feel it. But come tax time, the IRS says, no, you've got $20,000 in expenses, but the only thing you can write off as a tax benefit is the $3,000. And you still don't feel it, but it's there. So you make sure that you categorize and classify it as a tax professional, and you won't have to pay that $17,000. So when you're doing a $2 million deal, and we're going and painting all 100 rooms and putting carpet, and you're now spending $200,000 in rehab, it's a big difference. I'm talking about $197,000. Because the only thing you can write off is $3,000 as a real estate dealer, okay? So some of the things we do is we convert apartments to condos. Question?
Yeah, do you need to have a real estate license then?
No, because we're investors, we're not okay. Real estate agents. Agent. Do we have any agents here? Yeah, we have an agent. Mm-hmm. Two, okay. Yeah, we're private investors. If you have it, great. Everybody knows how I feel about real estate agents because they're tough to work with. Unless they have real estate investment experience, they will mess up a deal every time. Don't they, Angie? Every time. Okay. So we do real estate speculating and subdividing, vacant land to subdivision. I'm currently on my third one like that. And obviously the fix and flip. These are the things that are usually categorized as real estate dealers. And I'm going to show you how to turn that around legally so that you're not categorized as a dealer. These are the deal effects. The IRS will look at the following. The number of real estate deals you do. how long you hold the property, how much profit you receive, how much time and effort you put into selling it, how much improvements went into it, did you list it with an agent, time you spent on the investment versus what you spent on your job. So if you're working 40 hours a week, but you're only doing 2 hours on your job, the IRS is going to say, you're not a real estate professional. You're doing this passively on the side. It's counted as income. These are the negatives of being a real estate dealer. No 1031 exchanges. There's a lot of no's for being a dealer. Does everybody know what a 1031 exchange is? Who does not know what a 1031 exchange is? Okay, so you've had this property for 2-3 years and it's worth $250,000 and you bought it for $50,000. It's not your homestead property and you now have a big old whopping capital gains tax bill to pay. But you don't want to pay it. So the IRS says, look, it's okay, you don't want to pay it? That's fine, don't pay it. Just buy something like it or greater. And you can pass that on to that never date. And you do it. And you go on. But somewhere along the line, you gotta pay up, right?
Yeah.
So we're gonna teach you how to get past that. The other thing you can't do if you're a real estate dealer is you can't take the deductions if you're doing owner financing. So some of us will find a piece of property and it's worth 100, we put 60 in it, and we rehabbed it with 10,000, and we found somebody that says, I'll give you 120 with 30,000 down. And we'll go, yeah, I'll take it. You can, but you can't write off the expenses. No tax breaks. Self-employment tax issues. Who knows what the current rate of self-employment taxes are for us as individuals?
It's like 15%?
19.9%. That's just the self-employment tax. 19.9, so 20 cents from every dollar goes to self-employment taxes. We want to do away with that. As a real estate dealer, you can't. And there are no depreciation, no deductions, and no long-term capital gains, which we already discussed. Now then we have dealer positives, real estate professional positives. You can accelerate the deductions. There's no limit to losses. As a real estate professional, I should say professional,
okay,
there are no deduction limits. It's not 3,000, it's actually 25,000, so there is a limit. And that limit changes once you've earned over 150,000. Let me explain. On the same deal, we bought this house for 70,000, we put 10,000 in it, and we sold it for 100. For 10,000 in repairs, we made, 20,000? And at tax time, you deduct the 10,000 completely. But in addition to the 10,000, you have legal fees, your accountant, and you have a total of, how many of you know that you can actually make $20,000 and still be at a loss?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it be a good thing, mm-hmm. Right? And it be a good thing. So I bought this house for $70,000, 60, right? 70,000 plus 10 in repairs. It's at 80 and I sold it for 20. So I made $20,000 on a check. And then I said, well, I had to buy, because I bought it in my company's name, and I had to buy a new car to take me to the job or a new truck. And I needed some equipment that I really need. I was gonna buy it anyways. And I needed to meet with Celso at the, right here at the Burns Steakhouse to discuss the deal, right? We did. And so after sale, at the end of the year, $101,000. So I had a loss on that deal. But I made money. I got a new car, ate at Burns. And does everybody see it? Tax deduction? How much taxes do I pay on that $20,000 that I earned?
Zero.
Never. Pay never. Because it's legit. There are hundreds, literally hundreds of ways of reducing your taxes without evading taxes. Does everybody understand the difference between the two? They're just, trust me, there's just, if you're paying anything over 12% on taxes, then you used to see me and you used to fire your accountant or whatever to do the taxes.
Really?
I'm telling you the truth. As a real estate dealer, I found it, actually it should be professional, I apologize. As a real estate professional, I found it to be advantageous to use a C or an S corporation, even a limited partnership with, this is me personally, even a limited partnership with regards to tax paying perspectives. Let me explain. If you buy that same property and you sell it in your personal name, as a dealer, you have to pay that 19.9, the taxes, because it's income for you. If you buy it and sell it as a professional, and you have it in a corporation and you tax it as a C or an S, you don't. How many of you know that an LLC is a pass-through entity? That means that whatever you're paying on taxes, it passes through to you as well. So you also pass the taxes back to you. Let me explain. You bought that same house. We're going to use the same example for $70,000. You bought it in your personal name. How many of you know that you should not buy property in your personal name? How many of you know that now, after you've done it? Okay. You don't buy property in your personal name. And if you have to, because of credit or whatever, marriage or whatever, you do, and then immediately, what I do is I pass it on to a trust. Okay? How many of you don't know that? If you buy a property, I don't care if it's your personal residence, you put it in a trust.
Do you do that before you buy it?
No, you can't because you don't own it yet.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to own it to put it in a trust the day after. You can't even do it the same day. It has to be the day after. Okay? Now, because of, again, self-employment taxes, I do not use an LLC. I do an S-Corp or a C-Corp. I use a C-Corp because I expense everything through it. That's me. Now, I did consider using, and I did use my self-directed IRA. If you don't have a self-directed IRA, what is the difference? If you took your $100,000 and you left it in your 401k forever, 30 years or whatever, 20 years, when you retire, it may be worth $200,000. Because somebody else was doing it for you. You know the problem is that we like somebody else to do things for us too often. It's time for us to do stuff for us. Who do you think would do better, make a better decision for your money? Who would spend your money better? Who would protect your money better? Not somebody else who gets paid regardless of whether you make money or not. Self-directed IRA. If you don't have one, please get with me. Question?
Yeah, quick question, Mike. Now you say with a corporation you use S corp or C corp as opposed to LLC. Now some people will argue that you get better protection with the LLCs than an S or a C corp. You know, for liability issues.
Okay, we're talking about different things. We're talking about when I buy a piece of property, I'm big on asset protection. When I buy a piece of property, I don't buy it in the name of an LLC unless that LLC is taxed as a C or an S corp. I don't buy it just in the name of the LLC. Now, if I'm keeping it for a long time, I can put it on. If I'm keeping it for a year plus, I can put it in an LLC. We're talking about the issue versus dealer versus professional. As a professional, you can put it in whatever entity is best for you. But as a dealer, you don't want to put it, I won't put it in an LLC unless that LLC is taxed as a C corp or as an S corp. Okay? That as a professional, the maximum losses that I can claim is $25,000. I'll give you the example, how to make $20,000 and pay zero taxes on it. Also, I need you to know that claim of $25,000 diminishes as you start making $100,000 or more. Once you start making $100,000, they calculate two for $1. So if you made $25,000 in profit But you're making over, say, $112,000, then you could only claim $12,000.
Now, of course, would that just be for, let's say, your corporation?
That would be for your corporation or you as an individual, which you'd be crazy to do as an individual. You, yeah. Really for your corporation.
So if I have two corporations and they both make $200,000, or that's actually, let's say, if I'm at two corporations that make under $100,000, but total they would make over $150,000, then I can still deduct the maximum loss?
Yeah, if one of them is a real estate dealer entity and one of them is a real estate professional. I don't want to confuse you. Real estate dealer, bad. Mm-hmm. Real estate professional, good. That simple enough? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have three houses that we have and we bought it to resell it because we have to. Okay, bad, but okay because you have it in an LLC. And that's taxed as an S corp, okay? And then you have LLC over here, and it has long-term property, the three of them, that you're gonna hold on for the next whatever. And they all are $70,000 properties that you put $10,000 into it and sold it for $100,000. Is that okay if everybody understands that example? Now, they're all the same identical for the purpose of this illustration. Here you have, and you put $10,000 in all of these, you can't write off that $30,000. Everybody know where I got the $30,000 from? You have three pieces of property. You put $10,000 repair in all three of them, each. That's where I got the $30,000. You can only write off $9,000. Why? Because the maximum you can write off as a deduction and a dealer is $3,000. Now, on this side, we have corporation professional. We have the same three pieces of property. We put $10,000 in each one of them, but we have a $25,000 maximum deduction. This will be offset by this. Does everybody understand that? If you don't, please, I'll break it down. Not a problem. And if you don't want to ask me in front of everybody, ask me one-on-one. But it's real simple. What I can't write off here, I can write off here. So I actually have a $75,000, I promise you I'll have a $75,000 deduction. The maximum every year for every one of my properties.
Can I wrap other businesses into it?
Why?
Because I'm a freelance photographer and have income. That
different entity. That.
Okay, so you
do can. You can have. I have 13 different businesses. Okay. Different things. It's a mess at tax time at my house, I promise you. But it's good. It's a good mess. I promise you that also. Now, when I became a real estate professional, I was not bound by that $25,000 annual loss limitation. All right, real estate is a business, not an investment. That's what the intent. Are you in this for a business? Sweet. Now, in order to be a real estate professional, you have to meet three rules. Does anybody know what the rules are? Come on, I was making you guys look really, really smart. More than 50% of the time you spend is spent in business activities on real estate activities. Does everybody understand that? Mm-hmm. Everything you're doing is for real estate in the activities for real estate. My total time spent is no less than 750 hours. No less.
Per what?
Per year.
Okay.
Per week. For years. And I had to participate in the rental activity. How do you satisfy that one? Huh? How do you satisfy the third prong of that test? I had to participate simply. I'm the one that decides. I'm the one that decides how much rent they pay or they don't pay and when they pay it. 50% of the time has to include, all this is included in it, real estate rental activity, brokerage activity, if you have to talk to a real estate agent and so I help you sell it or whatever. Management, you have to be involved in the management. Now you know why I'm involved in the management of everything, right? And you have to be involved if you have to change the carpet or paint or cleaning the yard, or some type of, something that is categorized as construction, you have to be involved in it, which is why we are all participants. Because we want to meet that rule of professional. Does everybody understand that?
Are you going to have this on the website?
Yes, this whole thing is going to be on the website.
I have two people that need to look at this.
Okay. Okay.
Are you trying to find out the time?
Oh. Yes.
Well, my bad. You know, I had borrowed a charter. Sorry.
Yeah,
4:16.
Okay. All right. I'm almost done. Included in that 50% requirement, development, redevelopment, construction, you find it, you convert it, you rent it out. You just got to be involved in the management, in the leasing, in operating, which is why I teach you guys how to run hotels. What do you think? Some of you are learning how to run a hotel. Some of you are learning how to run an assisted living with us. I promise you, it's not just because you're putting in 15, 20 hours. You're going to learn how to do something so that you can write it off. You're learning so that as we grow, we will grow. I started saying earlier, and then I stopped because I wanted to wait till this moment. My wife said to me, why yesterday? We looked at a total of $20 million in real estate yesterday. She said, can you please answer me one question? Why are you doing it? She said, I just want to know why are you doing it. She said, I know it's not because of the money. So why? I said, honey, we have a goal to make $1 billion. And this is what I said to her. Are you contributing to your causes? She's got, you know, we help churches and things like that. Do you give now more than you did before? She goes, obviously. I said, so we're giving more at the $8, $10 million level. So how much do you think we're going to give at the $100 million level? Or the $500 million? I said, you can only buy so many houses, so many cars, so many boats, so many. You can only go out to so many restaurants, so much food, right? Then you do that. But you know what? It is a good feeling to know that you can do anything you want, whenever you want, if you want. And it's also a great feeling you can stay home and have a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and a glass of milk. As a professional, I could show property, include, I could look at the inspection, hire, deal with management company, improve, repair, evictions, write the ads, websites, the seminars, these are things. Why do I do seminars? It's multi-reason. Number one is, I get to write off stuff. I get to do this. I can't talk this much at home, I promise. I try, and they tell me, my kids, my wife, they go, please, Dad, please, stop, stop. And also because I get to teach other folks. If you haven't figured this out, I'm passionate about this stuff. I could do this every day. My wife won't let me do it every day. I have two rules, Friday afternoons and Sundays. And this Sunday I get to do a little bit more. Big one, travel. That's part of the business. What do real estate investors look for? Professionals all the time?
Deals.
So when I drive, check this out. How many of you write off, how many of you have a digital or manual log of mileage? Okay. How many of you are writing off the miles from your house to the supermarket? How about from your house to go pick up your mail?
En route to that property that I'm looking at, I'll do it.
If my intent to go to Publix, every week they put out a booklet. It shows rentals and properties for sale. When I go to the Publix supermarket, I go there to pick up that magazine. That's my intent. While I'm there, the IRS says it is not unreasonable for me to stop and shop. They don't want me to leave there, pick up my magazine, go home, and come back, because they're not unreasonable. They're crazy, but they're not unreasonable. So I get to shop while I'm there. How about this? For those of you that still have a JOB, with if you leave it up to me in the next 3 to 4 years, you won't have it, maximum. How about this? You drive from home to your job. You can't write those miles off, right? Mm-hmm. Check this out. How about you get a P.O. box for your home-based business or your real estate business, depending on what year investment you are. If this is your first year, you need a home-based business. I don't care if you do whatever you do, but you need a home-based business. Now, so I drive from home, and it takes me 15 miles to how long? Doc, how long does it take you to drive from home to the office?
9.5 minutes.
9.5 minutes, the equivalence of what, 6 miles?
6 miles.
6 miles round trip is 12, and you do that how many times a week?
5 or 6.
5 or 6, 6 times 12 is what, 72? Mm-hmm. Times 12, roughly close to 1,000 miles. All right, 800 and something miles close to, let's round it off at 1,000, is that okay? Mm-hmm. All right, 1,000 miles. Does anybody know what the mileage charge that you can deduct now is?
55 cents.
Do you know that for every 3 miles, it's the equivalent of $2.80? So that's $2,800 that you could not write off. But the IRS says it's okay for you to write off your miles from your home, if you have a home office or a home office, to pick up your mail at the P.O. box. So if there was a P.O. box down the road, over there on 4th Street, and you went to pick up your mail there, and it was your custom to drive by in the morning, oh, I got nothing, and then go to the office, then you can write off those miles.
Hmm.
Legal.
I'm getting a P.O. box.
Legal. That's a few bucks. You do that times 10 years, that's almost $30,000. Let's say you took that $30,000 and you just put it in your self-directed IRA or your Roth IRA if you don't have a self-directed IRA. Question?
So it's okay if you, so if you go from your home to your P.O. box, which is a business-related expense, and then go to the office, all that is deductible?
Mm-hmm.
Now it's on the way back as well?
If you because your intent was to go to your, get your mail. Now, what about your car? Can you write everything off on your car? If you have one car, no. You need another car. I don't care. How many of you have been to my house? Right? And you see that little, have you seen my real car? It's parked right in front, right? It's that Mitsubishi Eclipse, right? And I got, I got another one. My best car is a 1992 Toyota Camry that I have. Because that's, if the IRS says, well, do you do anything personal? Yeah, I got my Camry. My wife says, you know what? You're a weirdo. She says, you keep the $120,000 car in the driveway and the $1,500 car inside the garage. I said, honey, have you seen that car? I said, the only reason why I don't have the other one in there is because I can't fit it. It's ugly. It's rotted. It's rusted. It hasn't moved like in, I don't know how many years, but that's my car. Because when they're, yeah, I have another car. That's my car. It's titled in my name, registered, insured.
So my,
the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. Yes, sir.
As the business person, I have to have two cars? Or if my wife have a car and I have a car?
Remember that I won't give you any legal advice. I'm telling you what I do.
I'm just asking a question.
I'm being recorded. See that? I'm being recorded right now.
This is not legal advice.
If I wanted to write off my car, I needed to have a second car.
Okay.
What if your commute to your job is public transportation, walking, or a bike, where it is not a motor vehicle?
Then change it if you want a new car. If
okay,
not,
so you can't get a new car and then say that's for business?
You cannot, one thing that you cannot, that I won't do is I won't get a new car, ride my bike to the work and say that I'm deducting my car. I won't do that.
Okay.
Again, there's so many ways to deduct it legally. Because you know what the IRS does? They'll come to your house after you give permission. Do you know that they don't have, you don't have to let them in? They have to ask your permission. And they'll go to your neighbors and say, hey, pretty next door? They go, yes. Yeah, we see her every morning driving her bike. She drives her bike to work every morning. You think they don't ask? They ask. They ask everybody. And guess what? Get found doing one lie, they look
till you were about 3 years old.
Yeah.
Okay. Show rental property, I could inspect, I think I said that already, didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
Hire, deal management, big, travel. I hit the one button. Travel is big because you're always looking for deals. How about this? How about we decide we're going to go to Hawaii next year, right? And then from there we're going to jump to Japan because it's not that far. And then we're going to come back. What do you think we're going to go to Hawaii for? For the beaches?
Communities.
I'm going to go online and find a property, and they found, I see this property they want $1 million for. I'm going to go ahead and say I'm interested. Mr. John Smith, when I'm there, I can come up. Honey, when do you want to go over there? I can come up at this time, and I would like to set a meeting. How many of you have been to a place where they give you a timeshare presentation and you'll spend those 3 hours just to get 2 free tickets to go to Disney?
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? Right, so what you do is you set up a meeting with the owner of the property. Listen, I'm going to be in town at this time. My intent is to go look at that property. Well, I'm there. I might as well go ahead and go look at the beaches and, you know, do everything you do, right? And they want $1 million, and I bring a contract, and I go, you want $1 million? I'm interested. How about I give you $600,000 cash, but you only have $1,000 in your bank account? What is the worst thing that could happen if the person says, you know what? I'm just tired of this island. I'll take it. You lock it up, and you call us. Because it's worth $1 million, isn't it? That's the worst case scenario. Jump on a plane, look at a place in Japan. Guess what you went there for?
To look at another piece of property.
It's the intent. Bottom line is this. Knowledge is power. Knowledge is life itself. You want to get educated? You want to keep buying materials? Go for it. How many, Celso, how long have you been with me?
November.
How much materials have you have to buy? How much money have you spent on seminars and materials and DVDs and...
Not a penny.
How many deals are you involved right now?
I'm losing track.
We multiply times 4 every year. And we double our money every year. It doesn't matter if you're at that 5,000 level, at that 500,000. Now, will the person with $5,000 and the person with 500,000, who do you think will make more money? Neither. The maximum you can make is 100%. You're going to double your money. Does everybody understand that?
Oh.
You go from 5 to 10, from 10 to 20. How about from 500,000? Now, ratio-wise, you'll make more money because you started. So how about this? How about I find a $10 million deal, and this side raises $5 million, and this side raises $1 million. And we buy it for $10 million. Who do you think will make more money? Nobody. Everybody will make exactly up to 100%. I'm trying to get Q to, Q has been my oldest. When I decided to go and do this for others, Q Jackson is his name. Every week he says, Mike, I'm volunteering for, he doesn't work anymore. He was able to stop working 5 years ago because of the check he gets. He's so busy. He just recently told me, you know, Mike, I'm going to have to do something to get more money because I got all this free time. I'm telling you, they will change their mind. And he doesn't work. He says he loves being retired, and he donates time to the police department and the fire department and the whole bunch of things. Great. You know what? I want to get you guys there too. Pick a number where you want to be. A realistic number where you're at. And I'll get you there. How many of you know that we will do 4 to 5 projects in your group every day? So if we bought this $10 million project, how many of you think you cannot be part of that project? If I bought it, if I found us a $10 million project today, how many of you think you cannot be part of that project? That means you're either scared of raising your hand or you understand that it doesn't matter where you're at. You can be part of that project. Now, I met with a lady and she said to me, so let me get this straight. So if I give you this $25,000 for that $3 million project, I own that? No, you don't. You own up to 100% of the equity that you invested. The $3 million project is to secure your money. The next project, we're going to buy it and sell it. This is the part I do when we sit down together. The first one secures your money, which is usually a project that I either already own or that I'm buying. The second one, we rehab it and sell it. The third one, we rehab it and keep it as a group portfolio. And the fourth one, you get to keep for yourself. If you have not sat with me one-on-one, you need to. I don't care where you're at. Somebody said to me, then, why don't you do this for yourself? I did. I got the testimony of my kids and those that have been around us and are around us. We've been blessed. So now I'm going to do it with you guys. I can go on and on and on. So, I thank you.
The question.
Question.
Can I ask you, him over there?
Who's him? Celso.
Celso.
Yeah. So, what is your involvement other than investing money in the projects that you're involved with right now?
Actual physical. We, like the one we have going in Downing Street, we were in there and I actually, together with several other individuals, we've gutted the place ourselves, and right now we're rebuilding it ourselves. We're doing the actual construction on the facility.
I was curious.
Yeah.
Let me add to that. When I met him, November?
Yeah.
He said, Mike, I got a single family property. And I think you wanted
hard money.
How much was it? 50
or
60,000. $50,000. The property was worth 80. Mm-hmm. We're going to put about $10,000 in repairs, and then we would sell it for $80,000. So we would have made $20,000 in a group of four people, me and the three of them. And I said, that's a waste of time. That's good. But I broke it down for him. I said, the three of you, let's say you just use hard money, and I gave you the money at, say, 10%. So you would have to pay me back $55,000. And you sold it for 80, minus taxes, minus repairs, 10,000 in repairs. So you made $15,000 to be divided by the three of you, and then you got to pay taxes on it. I said, why don't we do this? Why don't we take that same house or a house like it, and we take it and we convert it into a 6-bed assisted living facility. And we put people in there at, say, $2,000 each. That's $10,000 gross income. And let's say it costs $7,000 to run it. And that would net $3,000. Is $3,000 better than $200 or $300 a month? But then, instead of taking that money and blowing it, we take that money and we put it towards another project. So now we have two projects. And then we take that money and put it towards the third project. So now we have three projects. And we use that money to double our money every year. And then next year, instead of doing a $50,000, we do $100,000. Instead of a 6-bed facility, we do a 12-bed facility. Does everybody get it?
Where do you get the workers for your assisted living facilities?
Right here.
So you have nursing home administrator license?
Oh, yeah. Raise your hand if you've taken the course, our license, or are about to take the course in here.
Oh, okay. All right. Because there is a shortage of workers in this industry.
Mm-hmm. I know it. I definitely know that. Which is why we're creating it. This is the thing. You either do it or you let somebody else do it for you. The letting people do it for me just hasn't worked for me.
The idea is whatever you're going to get involved with, mm-hmm. learn how to operate it.
If you said to me you were pick something. A doctor.
Don't pick that.
Let's pick something else.
A teacher.
What would I do? I'll show you how I think. Because I have no box. You're a teacher, and you've been doing that for the last 30 years, and it's great. I applaud teachers. They're underpaid, just like our police officers, our firemen, nurses, right? Well, for the record, about 25 to 30% of our nurses.
They have to be.
They are.
They have to be.
They are. We have some here now. Okay, teacher, what would I do? Tutoring center. You know how much money there is in tutoring, and you get to help others? The difference is we won't go rent a place and then throw money on rental. We would go buy a place and put up a tutoring center and some other business and...
Don't mean to hog the question.
No, that's okay.
So everybody here should indeed, and maybe they don't right away, be setting up a Chapter C corporation and LLC.
It all depends on what they're doing. This is why I tell people you have to meet with us one-on-one. When I say us, we have a group of us that we sit together with you, and we put together a plan, and you get to see. We put together a plan that fits what you do. We will not make you do things you don't know how to do. I don't want to waste time teaching you. I don't want you to waste your time teaching me. So I find out what you do, and we put you together. And if you don't know how to do any of that stuff, I'll give you, for instance, if she wants to say not, right here I have a professional lady who is a professional, and she said, you know what, I just don't want to stand around and do anything. So she went, and she raked, a couple of them cleaned up the property on Downing Street, and made it look, wow. Because you know what? I tell you what. Because if you remember what we talked about real estate professional, one of the requirements, what? Active participation. If you want to see me all painted up on Sunday, come on down to Downing Street because I got to go paint.
Yeah.
Now, I may only be for 3 hours, but I just have to be actively participating. Yeah. And I will be there on Sunday.
On the assisted tomorrow. Living facility,
let me know. Go.
You don't have to be there 24/7. You can share that with others in the group as long as you're all licensed, so that it gives somebody a break. You know, you don't have to be there every day, you know, 24/7. You get somebody who's there 16 hours a week or somebody who's 32, and then you just share it.
How about this? Check this out. How many hours does our doctor spend every day just filling out charts?
Mm-hmm.
Hours. Okay, let's say he does that for 3-4 hours a day. And he owns 25% of a 100-bed facility. So at the end of the day, he takes his 20 charts and he goes to the facility. He sits down. Everybody participates 15 to 20 hours in the project. And he takes his charts and he goes in and he says hi to everybody. He sits on the desk and he's there. Mm-hmm. Cross-utilizing your time. There's only so many hours a day.
Yeah.
So instead of sitting at his office for 4 hours to write the charts, he takes those charts with him. He sits at the ALF or at whatever, the other clinic or whatever. Now, what about this? What kills a business in the first year?
Payroll.
Because you got all this payroll. But no money coming in. But you have to pay it. You know what happens to employees if you don't pay them?
They
leave really fast. So what you do is, okay, so let's say the six of us do our first facility, and we have zero. We get licensed. Once you get licensed, you have to continue. Your doors have to stay open. ACA shows up. The door better be open. So we have no residents. So the six of us are there, and we're okay. I'm going to do my work from, 4 to 8. I'll be there from 4 to 8. And she says, well, I'll do my work and look for my real estate and everything from 8 to 3. And then we get a resident come in. And so now we can go ahead and we'll pull Chris out. We got one resident, then we got another resident come in. And we pull Celso out. And we got another one in, they pull me out. Did it cost us anything? No, the inconvenience may be that our work may be done at the facility. Now, will you be part of a facility in Jacksonville if you live in St. Pete? No. No. Because we don't want to inconvenience you. We want to work smarter, not harder. Smarter, not harder. Now, check this out. How about if I have an administrative license and I can be an administrator of each facility? That's the rules. So I'm the head administrator, and then I hire an assistant administrator, and I'm the head administrator. Within 20 minutes of all. So I make my rounds like the doctors do for 20, 30 minutes. I look at everybody, I'm okay. And look at the books, make sure everything's okay. All my policies and procedures are in place. Make everything happy in case ACA shows up. Because they do show up, right, Angie? They show up? They show up all the time, whenever they want. And if everybody's happy, I'm happy. And if ACA's happy, I'm really happy. And that's how we do it together. Apartment complexes, mobile home parks. And you've seen the booklet. If you're new, you looked in there, you go, there's nothing in here. That's because I teach you the stuff, I give it to you. Now, May 6 and 7 in St. Pete, I'm going to commercial on. 6 and 7, we're doing a crowdfunding project. Who does not know what crowdfunding is? Raise your hands, okay. I don't know everything either.
I don't either, crowdfunding.
Okay, crowdfunding is this. Think of you dead center in a stadium with 60,000 people, and you're saying to everybody, hey, look, I want to feed the homeless, and I want everybody here to give me $5, all 60,000 of you. Isn't that $180,000? All right? $300,000. I'm tired. Okay. $300,000. Can everybody you give me? And if you give me that, I'll give you this. And you go, oh, I really want this. What is it? I don't know. And so they give me money, and then I take it and I feed the homeless. That's called crowdfunding. But you're going to do it on the internet, social media, stuff like that. Do I have internet here? Yes. Check this out. This is May 6th and 7th, 2 days, boot camp, hard costs, 8:30 in the morning, hardcore. 8:30 in the morning until about 8 p.m. that night. The next morning, again, from 8:30.
Isn't it 7 to 9 on Monday, and then 8 to 8 on Tuesday?
Yeah, we're going to register at 4.
Right.
We're going to go, you're right, I'm sorry. We're going to start from 6:37, right, to about 9-ish. And then we can go ahead and congregate and do whatever. And then the next morning all day long. And then that night we publish our campaigns and bingo. We watch our PayPal accounts and they start going up. Check this out. Let's just look at that first one. This lady came up with a 3D scanner. She raised almost $400,000. Free money.
That's Canadian money, too. That's even more money.
How about this one? This is just somebody wants to do something in Singapore against anti-gay laws, and they raise $80,000. How about this one? Let's see. Wow. Feasibility study. I just want money so I can do a study. $70,000. 15 days left. Crowdfunding is our way of saying, you know what, I want to help to what you're doing. Now, this is the key though. These folks are giving something back to the people that are donating money. And in our case, we have a list of things that we give. And they're not really doing it because they care about your study. Really, I promise you they don't. What's in it for me? If you look at the, let's look at this one. They wanted $81,000, they raised almost $400,000. If you donated $449, you would get your own photo scanner, a photon scanner, and it includes all this stuff here. Let's get one with simple stuff. You
should play the videos.
Look at this one. Check this out. These people wanted $50,000 and they got $100,000, $96,000. You can get, if you give me $10, you can get five Batman comics downloads. What does that cost you? Nothing. How about this? For $25, I give you a Batman Superman cover. For $40, t-shirt, $100, your video game sign. Wow. They're getting some. That's our class, May 6th and 7th. June Hollishay, if you look her up, she's really good at what she does. What we're doing is we're doing a hotel stay the night, the next day, the food, the breakfast, the lunch, the dinner, the beverages. It's a boot camp.
All for $10,000.
Yeah, $1,000, $500 up front, $500 after you make your money. Includes everything. And that's because I got to pay her. If I could teach that, now, I promise you I'll be teaching the next one. It'll be free. I promise you.
Oh, is the 6th Labor Day or
something? The 6th and 7th of May. It's a Tuesday?
Monday and Tuesday.
Check out the
Wednesday.
The reason he's doing this is
because he has a
hotel. I think we can
do that
night.
Check out this.
I think the next day is going to be done. I think she'll be done. She said she would be done between 6 and 7. If anybody wants to stay, we'll work something out later. 6
and
7.
Oh, wait,
6
and
7.
So is there any shipping in Monday?
I thought we would be done by 9 or 10.
Just Monday. Monday night.
We check out on Tuesday. It ends at 7, 8 o'clock. Around 4 or 5 o'clock. I thought she said it was going to be on Tuesday, 9 p.m. or something.
The lunch at 9 p.m.?
No, the lunch.
Our lunch is going to be a kind of working lunch. Okay. It'll be a soup, salad, wrap, something like that. If I was doing law, I would do I'm raising money to help pro bono stuff. And if you guys give me $500,000, I need $1 million, but if you give me $500,000, I'm going to do a free clinic, and I'm going to do an online. How many of you have heard of, what is that commercial where you could do your legal work online?
LegalZoom.com.
Do you know that they're ranked number one in that department? How about if we did one like that, but we did it for free? People just pay like a membership fee. And the reason why we could do that is because we're going to raise $1 million to do it. And we need $1 million for a building, for the paralegals, and a couple of lawyers we're going to hire. You think people would donate if they could have a voucher? If they gave me $50, that they could have a $100 voucher for legal work up to $100. If they gave me $500, they could have up to $1,000. People were like, well, I know somebody that needs this help. Okay? I mean, this is a way of you saying, you know what, I need an extra $5, $10, $20, $50, $100,000, and this will help me with what I'm doing, and this will help me get started with the real estate. Right? You just got a boost. How about this? Everybody in here, we raised $200,000 combined. And then we went out and found a $2 million building. Would that work?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, you must comply. If you promise gifts, you have to give them. Rewards, and you must do the cause. We will do the cause. Okay? No questions. We're actually concluding right now, but for those of you that are doing the home-based business or need information on home-based business for tax write-offs, especially if it's your first year, you gotta have, I want you guys to compare the 2012 taxes with the 2013, when you do them next year, and if you didn't save at least 100% of what you did the previous year, I don't know what I'm talking about. You can save. How about this? Raise your hand if your car is in your name. Now, let's assume that your car is in your name and it's worth $20,000. And let's also assume that it's paid for. Is that car costing you anything?
Only insurance.
Yeah. Insurance, right?
Yes.
And whatever repairs or maintenance. Yes. So is that car an asset or a liability?
Liability.
Now, how about this? How about if I took my car that's in my name and I sold it to my company and I leased it out for, I don't know, I could lease my car to the company for, say, $500. That includes maintenance, repairs, and insurance, Isn't that $6,000 a year? No, but remember, you have another car, a little clunker. Right? A $500 car. And now you got a $6,000 deduction on it. Now your car is paying you to drive it. Is that good?
Mm-hmm. Great.
Now it's just pop. So we want those tax deductions. Also, I tell people, look, unless you want people calling you at 3 o'clock in the morning or 12 o'clock, like I get calls, you have a business phone. Have a business phone so that people, you shut it off, nobody calls you. I leave mine on for obvious reasons. I have a lot more callers than some people in California and so on. So I keep them on a little longer and I turn it on a little sooner. But you don't have to, not yet. So I recommend you get a second phone. You can get a Virgin phone, you can get a Metro PCS phone, you can get a phone with whoever you want, right? No contracts, or you can get it with us. It's what we do phone. For those of you that don't know, how many of you are familiar with Metro PCS? We're putting up stores just like Metro PCS, but it's a Verizon company. How many of you would say that Verizon is better than Metro PCS? Yeah, I would too. Well, that's what we're doing. We're putting up stores, hopefully.
You actually are putting up a store?
We're actually putting up stores.
Oh,
no contract, no social, no nothing, I guess, right? No deposits, so on. So, but anyways, and we're doing it in the form of retail sales. We're doing it in the form of home-based business, telemarketing, and so we have different groups to do all that. If you want to find out about that, you need a, I don't care if you do Malaluca, if you do Amway, if you do whatever, I don't care. You've got to have a home-based business. But if you're going to have a home-based business and you're going to get a phone, why don't you get a home-based business that does phones? Does that make sense? That's why we do it, especially for my first year students. Okay, any questions before I, all right, we're going to go, we're going to take a break, a five-minute break, and then Jonathan's going to teach us about the home-based business. Those of you that want to stay, great. Those of you that don't want to stay, good job. But set up a time with me. You want to get with me so that we can meet one-on-one. I don't care what you, if you say to me, Mike, all I have is, I don't care, $1,000. How many of you know that $1,000 will not change my life? How many of you know that $1,000 will change your life if you listen to me? Now, will it take you, if you say to me, Mike, I want to get to be, I'm going to retire with $1,000,000, and I got $1,000. How many of you know it's going to take a little work? And what I teach you, you're going to do it on the side, by yourselves, at the same time while we're doing together as a group. So you grow as we grow. Okay? So we're going to take a five-minute break, bathroom, whatever. And then those of you that are want to know about tax deduction, tax breaks, tax phone, and a home-based business, if you want to come back in 5 minutes. And please make sure you get with us. Thank you.